right, ladies and gentlemen, here we are again. Welcome to episode 2 of the Force Unleashed Developer Commentary. I am Sam Witwer.
And I am David Collins. Hello.
We're back. We're back. And with us tonight is a very special guest.
Yes, indeed. Joining us on Skype.
Indeed. And he will be joining us in just a moment. Hold on for a second.
The suspense.
I know. It's killing me.
The suspense.
Absolutely killing me.
Oh, hey, look. It's us.
That's right.
With headphones this time, so we can hear our special guest.
That's right. And we can hear the game.
Good evening, everybody.
Matt O'Marnick, ladies and gentlemen. Matt, what was your official title on the team, Force Unleashed?
On the Force Unleashed, I was the art director.
He wasn't like Supreme Art Director or like
Grand Moff Art Director? I'm pretty sure I thought it was Grand Moff Art Director.
Remember that.
Oh, yes. So I'm going to turn this down just a little bit so I don't blow out. Yes, I thought it was Grand Moff Art Director.
I liked it. I liked it as Grand Moff Art Director. Fear will put the local artists in line.
Fear of this video game.
And this art director.
So, Matt,
nice.
Thank you for joining us on this. It's funny, because Matt and I are working together right now, and so we've been talking about it this week. And one of the first things I wanted to ask you, Matt, was just, I mean, Force Unleashed, we talked about last time, was just huge in terms of the team size. How many people at maximum were working on art when you were at the peak of production on Force Unleashed?
Wow, that's a very good question.
Roughly speaking.
First, thank you guys for doing this. It's fantastic. I had a blast last week watching. It just like brought back so many awesome stories and memories. And yeah, just so happy you guys are doing this, number one.
You know who didn't have a blast?
Who?
Hayden.
Oh.
He's still alive. He's still making games.
Oh, he's spinning. Hayden Blackman is spinning in his grave. Hayden was very helpful. He is actually very encouraging, but also was very quick to point out where we got a few things wrong. And we're going to be sharing those tonight until we get him on this show. But I'm sorry, Matt, I completely interrupted you.
Yeah, we'll get to that part.
No, it's awesome. Yeah, it's like a really bad news report where you have to retract everything.
That's right.
We're just going to do it very quickly. And everything we said was wrong. But here's episode 2.
Exactly.
We'll do better.
No, no, no. It's just, you know, this is actually why it's great to have you on, Matt, because, you know, as I said in the last episode, you know, being the sound guy, and, you know, Sam being in the lead role as Starkiller, there was a lot of pre-production that happened as early as 2004 that I just wasn't even, I mean, you know, you asked me last week, when was the first time you heard about Force Unleashed? And I said 2005, but it was actually 2004. But you were on the team pretty early on, Matt. And when did you start on Force Unleashed?
Yeah, I think actually, and now we know Hayden will correct us, I think Hayden and I were the first two team members of the Force Unleashed, actually.
I don't remember it that way. I don't remember it that way.
No, me neither.
No, it was Sam.
Yeah.
But yeah, the team, I'm not going to be giving the exact number, but at one point internally, meaning just at LucasArts, working full-time on the game, there were at least 65 artists.
Wow.
But that kind of paled in comparison to the larger number with studios that we were using to outsource animation, modeling, texturing, concept art, our Singapore studio, ILM, the list goes on and on. So to give you a full number, I would say at max capacity, we were probably rocking, 130 artists easily. It was a very, very big team in general, a very, very big art team. Which was awesome. Absolutely great experience.
I remember seeing a demo, we talked about this week. It was a tech demo that featured Felucia, which we're looking at right now. Obviously, that went through a lot of iterations, but Sam, can you do, I believe if you do a force repulse here, you get some crazy tree action going on. Yeah, all these things kind of move and bend and sway. And I remember, Matt, you did this, we had this tech demo that we were doing for a long time. Can you remind me, when exactly was that finished? Was it 2006 that we did that?
I think it was. I think that's about right. That tech demo was one of my favorite parts of the entire project, because it was showcasing not only all the new technologies you guys talked about last week, but testing out our new tools and all our new rendering engine and working with shaders for the first time. And yeah, it was the first time that we all got to sit and go, oh my God, this is actually going to work. This is going to look really beautiful and function. And so yeah, I think that's about the right time frame.
Okay, and I just remember, you know, seeing, you know, the wireframe meshes kind of dynamically change in resolution. Is that about right when you were putting all that stuff together? I mean, was that proprietary at the time, or how did all of that work? Because the resolution that we were getting at that time, I mean, I don't even think the PlayStation 3 was even out yet, was it? Or it was just coming out?
Yeah, I think at that exact point, we had our hands on the Xbox 360 hardware, but Right. Maybe not the PS3. It came very shortly after that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we were learning a ton of new optimizations to make all this new technology run. And one of those optimizations, which is generally not uncommon in the game, which is have LODs, level of detail. So mm-hmm. the farther a model is away, right, it kind of triggers a smaller polygon version of that. And as you get closer, it blends between them. But when we were working with DMM and Euphoria and seeing these incredibly interactable objects, you know, big gelatinous blobby things that had a lot of polygons and verts, we actually found that showcasing that level of detail system was really, really exciting and really interesting to watch, because it was much more complex than anything we had done before. So you would get super close to some of these objects and you could barely even see polygons. It started to fill in, the lines were crossing so close to one another, it looked like a solid object.
Right.
And a lot of that credit goes to the technology that was developed in Xeno and Zed, and being able to push, you know, so many polygons on screen. That was just mind-blowing for all of us.
Right. Now, I remember, too, looking at Felucia. I mean, this was an interesting challenge creatively, because Felucia was in Episode 3 for, it feels like, all of 15 seconds, right?
Yeah.
And so it was like, well, let's create an entire world. Let's create an entire, like, fungal forest and a tribal race of beings and all this kind of stuff. What was it like kind of going through the concept art of that? Because one of the things that I always talk about working on Star Wars is that you're extrapolating on an idea that goes away on screen so quickly.
Oh, yeah.
But you live in it for hours. What was that like, just trying to put this level together, you know, from an art perspective?
Yeah, well, for example, we just passed by a slug that, to my knowledge, this is the only time you see these creatures right here. I mean, like, there's a level of detail in this game in terms of incidental life that must have been very time consuming to make, but it passes you so quickly, you know?
Yes. Yeah, time consuming is a good phrase. So Felucia, yeah, lots of really interesting stories about Felucia. So making a jungle level in any game is always kind of everybody sits back and goes, I don't know, should we do that? Because it's really a complex environment. You're dealing with, you know, obviously tons of foliage and the shadows that are falling and bouncing and trying to get that all to look accurate and have the density and make any kind of jungle-esque or forest look realistic is hard in the first place. Mm-hmm. So when we talked about Felucia, we were a little afraid, because we knew it was going to be, like you said, very time-consuming. But we embraced it wholeheartedly because of DMM and art, I think, are the two reasons. We knew that bending metal doors was really awesome, and we knew that crashing through wooden, giant gates was amazing. Right. But having something that showcased the more soft body features of DMM, that had never been seen in a game before.
No.
And so we knew that not
For our viewers who maybe didn't tune in last week, can we go over what DMM, Euphoria, Xeno, all these different things that we'll be referencing?
Yes. Let's not have the sound guy this time talk about all of the all of the visual stuff in the game.
Yeah.
No.
Well, or let me talk about the visual
stuff.
Let Sam
talk about
it. I felt
there you go.
By the way, I just felt it was very necessary to be able to do this. See what I did?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
look what I did.
Yeah,
and what did you call that, Sam?
I'm making the call.
What was that called?
I called it digital rubbery massive cup.
Digital.
I remember that.
Rubber spoon. There was a lot of meetings about rubber spoon.
Well, that was the thing. At first, we were hoping to do rubber spork, but we just did not have the tech.
No, no.
And so we were like, well, let's tell you what. Can we do a fork? And Matt said to me, he's like, you know what you really want to do now that we have all these curb surfaces is you want to do a spoon.
Yes, yes.
Forget the fork.
Well, there is a little bit of Taco Bell sporkiness going
right
on
there. Well, that was because Matt knew I wanted it.
Right.
But it's still
a
spoon. If you look at it, if you look at the wire mesh, it's a spoon. Matt put in the spork elements.
Well, game development is about compromise and doing what's realistic.
Let's
get that out of the way. No, but okay, seriously. So let's go back to.
First of all,
what is DMM? What is DMM again?
Yeah.
Matt, if you remember.
So, yeah, so the quick bullet. So DMM was developed by a company called Pixelux, who I think it was 2 years ago. Won an Academy Award for their technology, used in a bunch of films, a bunch of games.
Right.
Great bunch of guys. They were really kind of new and small, and they had developed this ingenious technology. And we boldly or stupidly decided to make it run real time and put it in Force Unleashed with everything else that we were trying to do. And it ended up being a great call. So DMM stands for Digital Molecular Matter, and this was the technology that Pixelux had developed. And in their demos, before we even had it running in the game, they would just show us these incredible scenes where you would destroy a bridge with a cannonball, for example, and it would behave physically exactly how you'd expect. It'd have rebar inside the concrete, and that rebar would bend and hold chunks of concrete on it, and things would collapse exactly how you'd expect them to. Which is very different than what had existed in games to that point, which were, you know, great physics systems, but they were
like
major
art swaps or something.
There was a lot of art swaps, right? And so DMM, Digital Molecular Matter, was the name that Pixelux gave to it. Was the technology that you see throughout the game. Every time you see something break or smash, it's breaking differently every single time. You're seeing materials behave the way that you would expect them to. And so that ranges from, like I mentioned, metal doors bending all the way to these gelatinous, blobby, awesome sporks that are, you know, shooting around Felucia. Mm-hmm. So that's DMM. And then Euphoria, you guys covered it pretty well. Dave, you did a great job last week.
Oh, thank you.
Euphoria, and similarly, was a full-body human animation simulation. So instead of an animator, you know, animating every keyframe of a character falling down, for example, and that having that looking the same every single time, or the animator creating 10 variations so that you create the illusion that it looks different every time. Euphoria actually built a nervous system within each character where it had knowledge, it had artificial intelligence of things like, I need to protect my head if I fall down, or that's a really far drop and that is not. So there was all this great logic built into Euphoria where you would just exert a physical force upon a character from a specific direction, and it would react accordingly. And muscles would tighten or loosen depending on how that force applied. So what you ended up with and what you see throughout the game is this really realistic and highly varied motion in characters.
And certainly entertaining to mess around with experiment with.
It made Force Grip.
So this demo.
Yeah, it made Force Grip like one of the most awesome parts of the game too. I remember it's the euphoria. You know, watching the stormtroopers just oh god.
That's right.
Yeah. And the demo that David's referring to, I think it's still out online somewhere where you can watch it. But it was just a fun playground. It was a Star Wars Natural History Museum that we built.
Right.
Different rooms, and it had these cool little trophies and all these different things, and it kind of crescendoed in this big cathedral-like room that had a giant rancor skeleton, just as if it were a T-Rex, for example.
Right.
You know, lit from above, smoky, really beautiful. And
Matt, do you remember there was a demo with Indiana Jones on like a rope bridge that was made public? Do you remember anything else, or am I imagining this?
Absolutely. So at the same time, of course, Staff of Kings was in development. Incredible work there. They were using these technologies as well, and they did a really stellar demo that was focused most on Euphoria, where you saw Indiana Jones standing on a rope bridge over this giant chasm, and with the Xbox controller, you actually controlled the rope bridge. So
right,
you could like wiggle it left and right, or tap it, or you know, and just mess with Indy, and he would try to keep his balance with no animation whatsoever. It would just be this simulation system built into his muscles.
I remember.
And so Indiana Jones is standing on this rope bridge, and you're trying to knock him off, and he's trying to counterbalance and catch himself, and it was just stunning to see.
There was something. There's sometimes he looked kind of like a toddler trying to keep his balance. I remember, you know, because it was it was just so like he ended up just doing that sort of like toddler just learning how to walk spread eagle thing because yeah, I forgot you were controlling the rope bridge. You weren't controlling Indy, so it was just like DMM just made it like you were just torturing all of these poor souls all the time, you know,
like I'm doing right now.
Yes, like yeah. Sam is doing right
and
now.
And I just have to comment like this moment, Sam, where you're pulling these Sarlacc teeth out of the ground.
Yes.
It takes a lot to get me queasy, but for some reason that always just like completely drove me nuts. This idea of just ripping a tooth and you can see the DMM and there's like the sticky gum and just rips. Still, I'm watching. I'm like, oh god,
that's horrible.
But
yeah.
It's so cool. Like, there's no other way you could have done that at the time. And so Felucia was really about showcasing the soft body characters of DMM and. It was the perfect place to do it. As you mentioned, Dave, there was a few shots and some concept art from F3, and that's really what we started with to develop the look and feel of it. And there's one particular concept piece that was done by Stephen Chang, amazing concept artist on Force Unleashed. She came from the Art Center. He also designed the Rogue Shadow, which is still one of my favorite items in the game.
Yep.
But he created this incredible vista piece of Felucia, and it captured everything that we wanted to achieve with that. Starkiller was standing up on this giant mushroom, looking out over this just vast, vast planet of crazy looking foliage. And what I loved most about it is that if you looked at it in passing, you'd be like, that's a beautiful piece of artwork, that's a beautiful place. But if you stopped and really looked, you would notice that 60% of the image is a giant Sarlacc pit that had been overgrown, right?
So
there was like, it was like one of those, you know, magic sailboat images where you sit there for a little while and you're like, oh my God, look at that!
You know what I remember most about the art at that time is...
Yeah, by the way, Matt, can you make sure that your speakers are turned down a little bit because we're getting a little bit of feedback on you.
Sure.
When we talk.
Absolutely.
Yeah. When we talk, yeah.
Yeah, cool. Yeah, one of the things I remember so much about the art at that time is that Jim Ward was having it put on canvas and mounted all over our new building at the Presidio. And a lot of those pieces are still there today. And like, so they just became like iconic parts of the building culture in a lot of ways.
That's right,
you know,
yeah.
Like, because I see some of these things, especially in the slideshow before we started, and I'm like, man, I remember walking past that and drawing inspiration just for how we would do the sound, you know, way before the level was even done, you know, because they were just these giant canvases on the wall. So that must have been pretty cool. Did you have a hand in choosing a lot of that stuff?
You know, before you answer, Matt, I just want to thank you because that experience was one of my formative experiences at for working at Lucasfilm, was all of your artists putting, you know, all this artwork everywhere of all these incredible Star Wars locations that I've never seen before, and Darth Vader, and also David Cowan's pointing at certain characters and saying, yeah, that's you.
Right.
so that you had a very large hand.
Huge
huge impact on me emotionally, being a Star Wars fan, coming in this building and seeing this stuff for the first time. It was incredible.
That's awesome. Can you guys hear me? I just switched to headphones.
Yes.
Yeah, perfectly.
Yes.
Okay, great. Yeah, that was that space, walking through that space for where the dev team worked on Force Unleashed. You're right, there was something extremely emotional about it. The size of the artwork that we printed up on the walls was just massive. We filled as much of the hallways as we could. And a lot of it, the vast majority of it, was really early concept art. Much of it done by Greg Knight, who gets a ton of credit for really helping established the Force Unleashed, getting us through a lot of the pitches and other crazy cool ideas that we had leading up to it. A lot of Amy Beth Christensen, of course. Mm-hmm. Walking down those hallways, we had vistas, I think, from every single level. We had these huge, tall, life-size printouts of the characters. Like you said, there was you sitting up there, Sam, even before we knew it was you, but it was you.
That was the weird. That was the weirdest thing about it, is that you'd created a character that I resembled. That...
Somehow we always knew.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
That's right.
It's Sorry,
Matt O'Meara.
But yeah, I need to try. I know where some of that those actual pieces still are. But I'm meaning to kind of track them down. I know they all still exist. I have a couple of them. So yeah, I got to pull those all together.
I think I stole
little mini museum. You did. Okay.
if there's ever if there's ever a shortage of places to put that stuff, I would love to give some of those pieces a home, because I mean, not even because there were plenty of images that didn't have me. So it's not just about me, but there was there was just such incredible work there, and it was very exciting to look at. And by the way, I also want to say the Felucia is pictured in Force Unleashed, because we saw it in the movie for a moment.
Mm-hmm.
Later we saw it in Clone Wars. So this is a planet that we've visited quite a few times at this point, but our Felucia is so dirty.
You know, I was going to say, I was going to ask you on that point, Matt, there was a rumor that there weren't jiving with you, or that you were trying to avoid. You had sort of like an art style Bible with this, right? Because you didn't want it to be like a rainbow looking world.
Yeah,
you wanted it to be. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Yeah, that was definitely one of the risks of doing Felucia, is that, you know, by its nature, it's super colorful, right? And yeah, that's wonderful, and that works really well in concept art. And you know, having a huge palette of saturated bright colors is awesome and gorgeous. But it's a completely different story when you're in a game, and you need to have, you know, visual landmarks where you know where you are. You need to see a character, an enemy pop against that. Yeah.
Speaking of which, I just want to say this was brilliant when you guys put all this like Clone Wars destruction and like this old armor of clone trooper armor down here on the ground, and the droid control ship, like the remains of the Clone Wars.
Yeah. I guess this indicates that they rotted in their suits, or little critters ate them out of their armor. Basically, yeah.
Totally. And you can kick, I think, all that armor around too.
Yeah, it's all physics. Yeah. But anyway, you were saying.
Yeah. So in this particular kind of world, if it were fully colored and fully bright and saturated, you would never be able to see an enemy coming. You would never pop off the screen. You wouldn't see holocrons. So we really had to reserve most saturated and bright colors for the most important elements, the ones that guide the player. Like, here's where you need to go. It's easy to get lost on Felucia, so we needed to be really cautious and careful with color, so that we could guide the player through and make sure that when a crazy Felucian comes running out at you, that you can see him, which explains the kind of day glow design in the Felucians themselves, and even the Rancor, as you see right here. Felucia was a great challenge that we knew we were taking head on in balancing color, really. So great artistic test, I guess, for the crew, and they killed it. I mean, Asier Levina, Marina Ree, I think at one point we had probably five artists working on just Felucia, because it was so complex and it needed so much balancing, but it was absolutely worth it. There's so much cool stuff going on here that I still, even today, I haven't really experienced in a real-time environment before.
And it's great because, you know, I just see that as a story beat, you know, the Dayglow paint on these guys is part of the tribal custom of the Felucians. But it's another great example of sort of art and gameplay and story just being kind of harmoniously working together, you know. No Skittles in this world, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, and also as a story point, this is a post-Clone Wars Felucia. The Clone Wars Felucia is a brighter, healthier place. This is a place that is now... You know, I mean, there's wreckage everywhere. The wildlife is maybe not doing as well. So, I mean, the dirt really does make it feel like a real jungle. But at the same time, there's...
Awesome.
You like that?
I knew he was behind me. I knew it.
Yeah, no, I have the force.
Awesome.
You know, one thing that we actually haven't talked about on the cast yet, Matt, is how good I am at this game.
I was going to comment on that. You were a little brave going with Sith Lord.
Yeah, well, we really should have gone for Sith Master, because look at what's happening here.
No.
I think so. I would have.
I will remind you of the Kazdan Paradis.
Oh, that didn't go well. Yeah, Kazdan really, like, humiliated me.
By the way, if anyone in that's watching live has any questions for Matto while we're here, please fire away. We're looking at the screen.
Do we want to do a couple questions right now before we continue?
I just was looking for a couple here.
Uh-huh.
And if I see one, I'll definitely bring that up.
And actually, I want to just on a comment that Sam made about Felucia, because I'm not sure if I'll
I'll be on when you guys get to Fallujah 2. But that was also one of the most exciting artistic challenges of this game, and Fallujah is a great example of this, where we come back and we revisit a few of these levels later in the game. Mm-hmm. And as you guys discussed last week, you know, The Force Unleashed bridges the gap between the two trilogies, and so there's this kind of imaginary moment in between the two trilogies where the Empire really gets a hold on everything. And so we had this really great opportunity to illustrate that, right? Mm-hmm. So early in the game, when you see Kashyyyk, for example, Fallujah, of course, things are still pretty kicking. They're still alive, right? Yeah, there's debris from the Clone Wars, all that. But when you come back to either of those worlds, we've completely trashed them visually, and to kind of just sell that changeover. And it also tied so nice with the character, with Sam's character, right? Because he makes this switch at that exact moment in the game.
Right. So
the
question we had about that is, how much work was that? Because obviously you're using some of the same assets, but you know, is it all lighting or?
Last week we were surmising. Well, let me tell you how hard it is Like last week we were going, I thought originally, because you know, reuse of space is always like a great, you know, production technique in order to
save.
Know,
maximize the work.
Yeah, like Arkham Asylum, right?
You know, Arkham Asylum, like you're retreading the same...
But that's not what was going on here, right? Revisiting Fallujah, revisiting Kashyyyk, they were like completely different art worlds. I mean, they might as well... And different terrain, right? I mean, yes. Go ahead.
Yeah, I think we all fooled ourselves on paper early on. With
so this
that
was true. That was the idea originally. Like, okay, like, good. I thought so.
Yeah. And it made a lot of sense. And I remember very vividly our lead environment artist, Mike Kawas, who's absolutely incredible, you know, speaking up and like being like, all right, guys, cool, great, but really, it's not going to go that way. This is going to be, if we want to look good, it's going to be amazing. And I'm like, yeah, I know, but let's do it. So,
and the producers
What's that, Dave?
The producers know too, but they're playing that game to try and at least try to get you to think that way, you know, so that if they're even 10% successful, maybe, you know. But yeah, everyone knows it's never going to go that way. Anyway, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it worked out great because you still, I would give it, I don't know, pulling this out of somewhere, but probably 15 to 20% was reused, right? A lot of these models are the same, but every single one of them gets touched, gets you know, a model tweak, gets a new shader. Obviously, lighting is huge, rearranging everything. So yeah, they're effectively new levels. But I think the way that this tied into our story was great, and it really, really worked well with what was changing in the psyche of Sam's character. And what was happening in the galaxy at the time, right?
Well, that's the thing. You can't really redeem the character unless he is going and seeing the consequences of what he has helped to bring about. Working for the Empire and
precisely,
yeah.
So we have a couple of questions here. One of the first one is Matt. What's your one of your favorite pieces of art for The Force Unleashed? If you have any.
Wow. I mentioned that Fallujah concept art piece.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Got so much concept art went into this game. It's. I would love to be able to check and see globally other games to see really how we stack up, because I think it was a massive conceptual effort. So a lot of my favorite pieces are in that conceptual phase. We had such a talented and creative, but not to mention passionate for what we were doing, passionate for Star Wars, team of concept artists. So the ideas that came out were, they made the game. So the Fallujah piece definitely comes to mind. There was a few environment art pieces for Kashyyyk that were incredible.
Oh, yeah.
Wow, that's a really tough question. That's a really tough question. If this occurs to me, I'll let you guys know, but wow.
One of the things that that I loved about the first one was that you go from Kashyyyk to TIE Fighter Construction Facility to Raxus to Fallujah, and in terms of look and feel and, you know, sound, performance, everything, they're just four incredibly different worlds right at the top of the game, which to me has such a George Lucas visual language style to it. Do you want to comment on that? And in terms of your comments with Hayden about the progression of at the beginning of the game?
Well, one of the things that you know, when you watch...
Oh, what did you do, Sam? Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'll tell you what we did. No, no, but one of the things about doing a Star Wars movie, when you see a Star Wars movie, you really, at the end of the movie, the beginning of the movie is very different from the end of the movie, and you really feel like you've gone on a
huge journey.
Huge journey, and right, and a lot of that is the art. A lot of that is just how many places you see, and the how broad the color palette is in terms of the different textures and colors and feelings that you get from all this all these locations. So I mean, again, Force Unleashed has that feeling where you really feel like this character's been on a journey because he literally has in these environments.
Yeah. So can you just elaborate on mm-hmm. sort of the planning of that and how that kind of came about? Because there were levels that were cut at some
yep.
point. Anyway, go ahead.
For sure. Sure. Yeah. I think at the highest level, I've always been a huge Star Wars fan. Working on Star Wars is probably the major pull that brought me to LucasArts in the hopes that I would get to work on a game like this. Artistically, Star Wars for me is probably the greatest IP you could possibly work on for a variety of reasons, and you guys are touching on it here. One, you've got in Star Wars, in especially the original trilogy, you've got this huge galaxy full of all kinds of varied planets and aliens and, you know, everything anyone could ever imagine. But at the same time, every object in those worlds is kind of Earth-based, right? It's gritty, it's used, it's recognizable to us, right? Which really had never been done in sci-fi up until George. Sci-fi was always, you know, very exaggerated or very clean, and Star Wars just had this Earth-based believability to everything.
Right.
Yet on the other hand, you can do anything you can imagine in Star Wars, right? There's no limit to the amount of planets that can be created or what they are composed of or what creatures may live on those planets. So artistically, the ability to be able to do all this, but to be able to really speak to people and have them identify with what they're seeing, I think that's one of the major guttural appeals of Star Wars and why it was such a successful series of films, is that blend. And so in our planning, I think we recognized that very early on as very unique to Star Wars. Mm. And so we wanted to make sure that Force Unleashed had those characteristics. So we're going to crazy places, but we worked really, really hard to make the objects and the characters and everything that you see have this Earth-based realism to it. And I like to think that we're really successful there. That's probably maybe the spirit of what you're talking about or what you're experiencing.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think that's exactly what Sam you were saying.
That's how we did it. That's how we did it.
Right.
There we
right.
go. That's right.
What, yep. This is what we did, and this is why.
Yes, I mean we actually did that here.
Right here in my little office, in my mind.
Actually, we had another question about costumes and all the different costumes that we talked about this briefly last time. But yeah, this is the. This is the svelte everyone has their shirt off level, for example, like because it's probably hot right. and humid and stinky. But can you talk about the different looks of the characters as they go through each level as well? And a lot of cosplayers. I love, by the way, just as a side question, when you go to, because you and I were at Celebration, I know, at least once together. And when you go to Celebration and other cons, you see a lot of Starkillers. Can you talk about the inspiration behind all the different costumes?
Absolutely. Amy Beth Christensen. Just boom, there's your one answer.
There she is.
She's a goddess, and
she's amazing.
She was our senior concept artist, and really, you know, along with Greg, of course, everyone gets credit there, but really, she was the artistic heart of this project. Her passion and knowledge for Star Wars, she came straight to LucasArts right out of college. She was already a super fan, you know, beyond almost everyone there, I think, the day that she arrived. So her in-depth knowledge of Star Wars visually is, I'm sure, to this day unmatched. She's currently working on Rebels along with Chris Foy. Mm-hmm. And I remember Amy doing a presentation very early to a lot of the artists where she had this big keynote. Sorry, it was probably PowerPoint back then. presentation about Star Wars clothing. And that was the entire presentation, was the details of Star Wars clothing. Like, you will, you know, here's exactly how a lapel looks, and you will never see this kind of button, and you will never see this kind of thing, and, you know, racing stripes are always going to be at this particular angle. And she had this stuff in her head. I mean, unbelievable. And so from her original concept design of Starkiller and to designing many of these costumes, it was all built upon those rules that she had somehow pulled together about Star Wars in her own brain. And so I think you guys mentioned this last week, the progression of Starkiller's costumes, we tried to make very, very logical, and each one have a story behind them, right? think Sam, you had mentioned in Raxus, right? It's the same costume. He's just kind of gone into the trunk in the back of the Rogue Shadow and said, "Oh, what the hell do I have back here? Let me just throw on this weird thing." And
right.
And so we really thought about every element that he's wearing having a real story and being a logical progression for what this guy would do if he's like, "All right, I'm going to Hot Sweaty Planet. What do I got to do here? Rip off a couple sleeves." So a lot of effort and thought went into the design of each of Starkiller's costumes, and then the execution of modeling and shading this character is incredible. Our character team, led by Dave Smith and Manny Lamas, Yoon Kim, were some of the best characters.
Manny created our HUD, by the way.
Our HUD for this live stream.
For this live stream, yeah.
Yeah, go Manny, go Manny. Craig Matchett, those guys were the best character artists that we could find across the globe at the time. And we were very fortunate to bring in a super talented group of artists. And so, between really strong conceptual design, great execution of the concept art, and then execution on building those models, I think we were really successful there. I'm very proud of that stuff.
That's great. And it probably does a lot to explain the different look of Shaak Ti as well.
Yeah.
That this is a really hot place, that these guys would be, because Shaak Ti looks very different.
She looks very hot.
She does.
Right.
She's different.
That she does.
Yeah.
No, let's just, as long as we're okay with that.
Let's just say what it is.
That's right. It looks really
hot. Pretty good.
Yep. Craig Matchett was our hot filter. He was, we had to run it by him. He was one of the character artists. And yeah, if we needed it to be hot, give it to Matchett.
Yeah.
Cool.
God, this is amazing. Look at this level. I mean,
yeah.
Oh, God. It's.
This was one of my favorite, just conceptually, the idea that you would have a Jedi fight over this giant Sarlacc pit. And Matt, the scale of Sarlaccs in this game. All right, hold on. We'll just let the dialogue play a little bit here.
If we can hear it. Can we?
Vader's assassin.
We can.
Welcome to the ancient abyss.
So you're actually about to walk out onto the concept art that I mentioned. That's basically the reveal moment that's about to happen as you come out through this little opening is essentially that piece.
Yep. And now we're battling Shaak Ti,
which
we're probably a few seconds ahead of you, Matt, in terms of visually what we're seeing.
Oh yeah, I got a little leg.
I wanted to, by the way, credit you guys and David. You were included in this. When I played this for the first time, the something about the location and the music that was chosen for this, I really felt like I was doing something very bad.
Mm.
I felt like I was really committing a crime, which is.
Well, this is another turning point, in the Starkiller story, right? It's just, I love the progression of the story, and Mark Grisky's music was great. And, a lot of this sequence, the Force powers, all of the QuickTime events, all that sound was done, I shouldn't say all of it. We had a huge sound team, but Tom Bible did a lot of incredible work on this. There's just so many elements that came together. But yeah, Matt, wasn't the Sarlacc in this game just something like, I don't know, 25 times bigger than the Sarlacc in Jedi, or even more, in terms of scale?
Sarlacc Unleashed.
It was Sarlacc Unleashed.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah, I think 25 is the number. One of my favorite memories, too, I remember the first time that we created the kind of scale and the size and put this Sarlacc pit into art and put it into 3D, and we put DMM on it and just started walking a character on it, and the settings of it were super jiggly, and so it's just like this huge waterbed. It was awesome. we probably lost a few days of like dev time just because everyone was playing with the jiggly waterbed Sarlacc. It was awesome.
I remember that. Yeah, I remember the sort of membrane type surfaces that you could sit there and bounce around on. And it's one of the interesting things about, if I may, about Felucia is it's a forest planet from a sound perspective that sounds nothing like a forest. I remember challenging Eric Foreman at Skywalker Sound, who did pretty much all of the ambient beds for this world. You got to make a forest, but it can't sound like there's birds in it. Oh, you died.
Okay. I took a nap.
You took a nap. That's good. And so how do you make a forest that doesn't have any birds in it? How do you make something that doesn't sound anything like Endor or some fantasy movie or video game, and he really did a great job using kind of insects and alien sounds and things like that to make it feel kind of the way it looks. And one of my favorite things about this Sarlacc level is I did one of those sound designer tricks where I took a recording of a baby burping up, and I pitched it down probably like 3 or 4 octaves and really brought out the low end. And that sort of pained, you know, monstrous innocence of the Sarlacc is actually just, you know, baby cries pitched way down. Especially in that last cutscene is probably where you can hear it most prominently. But that was one of my more fun moments of... Between
That's
that,
awesome. I didn't know that one. That's
yeah,
awesome.
Between that and like a Thai noodle dinner that I ended up putting in front of the microphone, you know, very much like Ben Burtt did with the casserole for Jabba the Hutt's sliminess. I kind of took a page out of Ben's book there and did the same thing for the slimy tentacles that you hear later on in the game. You know, just all that squishiness. And, you know, we recorded one of my frozen dinners where we were working late one night. And that was, it was all noodles and chicken. And it was like, yep. You know, and that, awesome. All those sounds are in there. And, you know, Brian Tibbetts and a bunch of people did an incredible job scripting all that stuff up. And, you know, there's it was just such a... It's so fun working in game development when you see all the elements come together. You know, it's... You're letting him pat you. The Sarlacc is saying...
It's saying, good job. Rest. You're doing really good. You're doing so good.
But since we're talking about me, I just want to extend this.
I just want to say...
It will be fine.
Yes.
Let's see if we have more questions. Oh, one of the questions that came up, Matt, was, did you work on the PS2 version? With Chrome?
Right, so I oversaw that from an art direction point of view and was out there, I think 3 or 4 times with the team, especially early on to kind of get them up to speed on what we were doing. And so, yeah, I approved the assets that came through and worked really closely with those guys, but they were in Australia, so it wasn't on an exact day-to-day basis. But really impressive what those guys were able to pull off. They started much later than we did. Right. So in one hand, they had some of the luxury of being able to see the assets that we are creating, but we were a big team moving 1 million miles an hour, and so those guys get a ton of credit for making a really great PS2 game.
Well, and not only they were doing cross-platform, right? They were doing PS2, Wii, and PSP, I believe. So they had their hands full. I mean, that's the thing about The Force Unleashed is at the time it was 3 different development studios working on this giant Force Unleashed program, right? Because even licensing was making action figures and things like that. But, you know, it was, we were doing the 360 and PS3, and which later ended up on what you see here on PC. That was done internally with the LucasArts internal team. But then there was Chrome that did the Wii, PS2, and PSP, and that's a different game from the ground up with a different engine and different controls. And then there was another company doing the DS, Nintendo DS version, and then eventually put it on PC. So there's like 7 SKUs in this game. Is that right?
Launching simultaneously.
All launching simultaneously. That's right. So if you remember, the action figures came out in 2007 and the game came out in 2008.
That's right. That's right.
Well, it was Star Wars 07 is what it was called.
Yes, it was called Star Wars 07. Yeah, I love this.
Obviously, we didn't keep those guys busy enough. That was the problem.
Right.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
God, that was so interesting. One of the things that we'll talk about a little bit more, because we know that you have limited time, but we'll talk about it a little bit more later. But one of the things that was great about having the PlayStation version, the PlayStation 2 version, was that some of the scenes that we couldn't finish because of time got to go in those, got to go in that version of the game. You know, the whole Black Five Squadron and the Battle of Callus and
all the Juno,
Juno backstory stuff. That was very important, but ultimately we just didn't have time to finish it.
And there were all new levels, like the Jedi Temple and Jedi villains Temple. And all kinds of Cloud City,
Cleef, right?
Mm-hmm. Wasn't there? Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
So.
Anyway.
So, yeah, this is a great cinematic coming right here.
Oh, yeah, see what we got.
You are Vader's slave, but your power is wasted with him.
Those are those baby
You could
sounds.
Be so oh, much right. more.
You will never convince me to betray my master.
Poor boy.
I love the giant flying manta ray creatures.
Yeah.
But I'm
zinging through the sky. Soon
enough. It's a great musical moment here too. Then all the Felucians.
I love this, Do something.
Now, I know that's Luke's lightsaber ignite from Jedi, but I specifically wanted it because the way that cut, I mean, it was just such, almost like an instant ignite, and it sounded threatening, and sometimes you just take dramatic license and use a different saber ignite.
My mission is complete, Master. Right.
Here's another cutscene.
You are ready to stand the moment against the Emperor.
This is a big cutscene.
Return to my ship at once.
This is a huge cutscene here.
We will at last.
It's one of the biggest in the game.
The galaxy.
It seems that you are about to achieve your primary programming, Master.
Yes. Finally.
Master, you have put one.
Smell that. Yeah, building our cutscenes was, again, one of the more exciting, I think, the elements of what we did at Force Unleashed, because we decided early on that we didn't want to do what a lot of games had done to this point, or games of this style, which was just straight up outsource the cutscenes to be pre-rendered and try to match the game look as best as they can, which never really works. And so you end up being kind of pulled out of the experience. We wanted, ideally, the cutscenes to all be real-time. We weren't ultimately able to do that with all of them. But what we were able to do was render out the cutscenes from the game engine, frame by frame, and then stitch them together as movies, and then we were able to kind of touch up and clean up things here and there. So we ended up with, I think, a really nice kind of sweet spot where you never felt like you were jarred out of the game visually, but the cutscenes had this little extra layer of polish to them, this little slightly nicer lighting and compositing that just, I think, went well with the extra love that went in the audio for these, the acting. So I felt like we hit a really nice spot.
It was kind of a happy accident.
It ended up working out to him.
This is Sam playing against Sam.
Yes, kill him.
I love the way you mix this.
Yeah, the perspective shifts there.
And also the musical choice.
That's all Jesse Harlan. And this little grunt here.
I was very... This last moment right here. That I was like, oh, you took Ian McDermott's laugh at the end.
I was like, no, that's you.
Like, really?
Yeah, no,
sweet.
That was all you.
I was so happy to hear that because I felt like such a faker doing the Emperor.
Yeah, but Matt, to your point, so what was great about the fact that this was not all done, it's in-engine assets rendered in the engine, but then played back like movie files, is that I was able to just mix them like movies, and we were able to give them a level of polish, and suddenly we didn't... That's Hayden Blackman's voice, by the way.
There he is, Hayden
Lord Vader,
Blackman.
He's regaining consciousness. I love this right here. The sound here. Huge scream.
That might take the cake of the best cutscene in the game.
Yeah.
You killed me!
One thing we put a lot of time and effort into was, of course, the likeness capture and facial animation, which was so far ahead of its time at the time. One of my favorite moments of the game, I remember this. It was the first time we brought the cast in to the sound studio, down to the mocap stage at ILM to capture everyone's likeness and all their facial expressions. To get things right, we actually put the actors in makeup.
Adrian was in makeup, and so was Colleen.
Down to his scar. And again, that's not required. And I think, as you pointed out last week, Sam, it was quite unusual to even use the same actor for their face and for their voice at the time. But we were hoping that the finite detail that we were going to be able to get out of facial expression here would be broken if it wasn't the same person. So finding really stellar actors who could act the part facially and vocally was extremely important to us. So taking that one step further, we're like, okay, if we're going to capture their likeness and we're going to capture every little scrunch of their brow and every expression on their face, let's put them in makeup so that we can grab those little teeny minutiae moments. And one of my favorite moments is we had everybody made up and we had done a round of the likeness capture, and then we walked the actors up into the dev team. And for everybody, I think almost everyone on the team, it's the first time that they've even seen the actors, that they've been modeling and texturing and working on for months.
They were like rock stars. It was a trip. Everyone was like staring at you guys.
It was the cool. Yeah, it was the coolest moment. We had Cully, you know, just walking in and as a badass. And Cully's a massive dude. He's huge, right? Right, and you know, we had Adrian, you know, everybody in Sam, everybody came up, and they were pretty much like half in costume, but full makeup, and just cruised through the dev team, and we're like, hey, animators, who's animating me? Nice to meet you, and it was just this really stellar moment, because no one expected it, and you know, here you are, a character artist working on this highly detailed character, you turn around, and there's this person looming over you, staring down. It was just a really fun moment. I think on both sides, both the cast and the dev team had a great time with it.
Well, from my perspective, going in there, having everyone almost know you already, because they'd all been working on the game for a long time.
Yeah, right.
So to meet the characters, there was a familiarity that they had with all of us. And I remember Amy Beth Christensen especially. She couldn't take her eyes off any of us. She was looking at Adrian and Natalie and Cully and me and just being like, but I dreamed you people. You're real.
Yes. This is a moving source of data. I don't have to guess how your flesh moves when you talk. Why are they staring at my face like this?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. By the way, just really quickly before we get too far from that last cutscene.
Yeah.
One of my favorite moments of that last cinematic was Hayden said he referenced. He's probably going to correct me this in an email later on, but I'm going to say it anyway. No.
Spitting in his grave.
Spitting in his grave, but he's still alive. The elusive Hayden Blackman. No. So this moment of. The sort of fake out gag where Vader puts his finger on the button and the reaction of, is he going to kill me? He called that the tote coat hanger gag from Raiders.
That's right.
Which really is kind of a nice moment of like, am I going to die? No, it's fine. It's just a coat hanger. I'm going to release you from your shackles. Anyway.
Lord Vader, rise.
Yeah.
Sort of. I'm trying to recreate that moment here.
Can I do it?
Oh, I see what you're doing.
Yeah.
I thought I...
Where is Padme?
Is she
safe? Is she safe?
Is she all right?
Well, yeah. I kind of decided that she's kind of okay. She's in a better place.
But I thought that I had left her alive.
Yes, well, you didn't.
No,
you have anger issues, and I'm going to... Yes, that's exactly it. We're going to take you, we'll put you in Imperial therapy. Yes, go on, rah, 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 rah. Oh,
crash,
yeah.
Crash, destroy.
Yeah. That's what the part of the scene we didn't see.
Right, that was the deleted scene.
It was in the PS2 build, though.
That was in the PS2 build of episode 3
of the movie.
Yes.
Yeah.
It might have been in the F3 video game, I'm not sure.
By the way, another really wonderful thing is that, okay, now he's supposed to assemble his own little army. And they give you the blue lightsaber crystal, which is just appropriate when you start hearing the music. You start hearing the ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Start hearing that theme starting to be introduced. So it feels entirely appropriate to equip your lightsaber with a blue kyber crystal. Yes.
And meanwhile, Proxy's trying to kill you still in this entire
yes.
level.
I've
turned everything off, and so now we're hilarious. Going towards this giant star.
That's the thing I love about this level is should just be an escape or get to your ship, but Proxy decides to turn it into a gauntlet of death for you. It's like, oh, by the way,
totally.
You know, fight your way out. Like, yeah. But we could have done this quietly, Proxy.
Yeah. Hey, we got
another
question.
I love how
question.
You guys talked about the...
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah, sorry, I was just going to comment. I love how you guys talked about the timing of Proxy as far as last week is so good.
Oh, he's the master jump stuff or the
jump?
Absolutely. Oh, you mean the Darth Maul thing?
And just showing up. And I mean, I always thought of Proxy as Kato from Pink Panther,
yes.
Which is still one of my favorite characters of all time. And like, dude, you just nailed it with that. Just like, just his tone and oh man, such a good character. He's got
to
come back.
But he's so cool because he's like, I refer to him as the Shang Tsung of Star Wars, you know, because he can become any, you know, for you Mortal Kombat fans, he can become any other character. So, you know, there's so many things you could exploit with that character. It's such a great idea. Yeah, and the stormtroopers are freaking out, you know. I think Cam wrote a lot of these lines, Cam Sui and one of the other designers. The stormtroopers just like, the escape pods, they're all gone. What? Why?
Empty. Wait. Orders.
And I use this opportunity to put in a couple of new weapon sounds, I remember. There's this rocket launcher that kind of has like a spitty... I think I cut in a little bit of a Republic gunship into that...
Did you?
Into that sound to kind of give it that sort of... I can't remember. There it is. Yeah, that sound.
I don't remember. It might not have even been me.
It was
someone else.
Well, no, that one was me. Everything else, I was just, you know, reading comic books.
That's right. You know what? By the way, I just want to say the Imperial officers, whoever you got to voice them, just it's like the fear they have when somebody. Yeah. Oh no!
Yeah, I think that's all Jerry and Monroe. I think that's Jerry and, he's great.
Hey, by the way, let's examine this design by Matt Omernick and his team. Look at this nice, cool new Stormtrooper design. Let's like if you look at him underneath him, look at all that detail. Oh, look at that. Look at oops.
You really just want to throw him around.
No, I wanted to examine
him. Totally.
Let's go bowling.
He's dead.
Yeah, they're really cool designs. Stormtrooper, I love this environment too, the Empirical. This was all done by Carl Wattenberg, one of our senior environmentalists too. Good old Carl. He's a wonderful dude. And again, just Star Wars to the core since the day he was born, and it shows.
We did get a question about, we get the question about, is there going to be a third one all the time? Obviously, we're all working on different stuff.
Proxy,
so
what did you just do?
Oh, here we go. Here's Proxy. He's so proud. I sent the nearby star. Yeah. So good.
I love that I'm actually, several seconds behind you guys, because as you're talking about analyzing the Stormtrooper, now I see what you're actually doing.
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah, no, I was examining him for you.
Yes, we were taking a good look. But one of the things I wanted to bring up, Matt, is, and I think this would be great to do this in general on this series, is kind of profile what everyone's doing now. Matt, I wanted to put in a good word and a plug for what you're doing and give you an opportunity to just talk a little bit about the project that you are spearheading that I'm very lucky to have been brought in on, which is your new company, Achille Interactive, and what you're doing right now.
Yeah, so congratulations, by the way. It's so cool. Yeah,
so all you watching this is going to be really cool. Check this out. Matto's doing some really groundbreaking stuff here.
Yeah, thanks. Cool. As Dave mentioned, our company is Achille Interactive. And what we're doing is actually kind of difficult to explain, but pretty awesome. We are making what hopes to be the very first FDA-approved video game, which sounds a little crazy. We've been working for several years, almost 4 years now, with some incredible cognitive neuroscientists. And we're building upon some really great technology and science that shows that we can use a video game as medicine. And we're building games that treat cognitive disorders such as ADHD, autism, depression, and putting these games and building them from the ground up as medicine, as science, but they look and feel like a consumer quality, great, fun video game. And what we're showing in early data and continuing to test and validate is that our hope is that we can be as effective as medicine in many cases, as effective as things like Ritalin in helping and treating some of these cognitive disorders, but doing it in a way that is not scary, not dangerous, and actually enjoyable and fun.
A fun, real video game. Yeah. Like something
absolutely.
You don't know that it's medicine. It's actually just a really cool game, but all the data collection behind the scenes is what is basically informing your primary care physician or whoever your doctor is that's prescribing this to you, potentially, of your improvement, your cognitive improvement. Is that right?
Absolutely. Yeah, and something that we learned early on in talking with some of the neuroscientists is that these guys, these incredible PhDs, are studying the brain. What they've been looking for, three decades, four decades, and what we as game designers have been looking for that long have kind of been the same thing. We've been searching what motivates people, what rewards them, what do they respond to, what engages them, and really what makes them tick and make choices in life. And
game designers
we've all been
do that intuitively, right? I mean, game designers.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah,
and so we've kind of been approaching this problem in two entirely different ways, but it's incredible when they meet how similar it is, and being able to leverage both of those worlds, it's been an insanely cool experience and continues to be. And we've been able to bring wonderful folks like David and some other of the best folks I've worked at Lucas to be involved.
There's correct me if I'm wrong, Matt. There are five of us from the Force Unleashed team working on this. You and Adam Piper. Yeah. Mike Kaywas, JJ.
Yep.
And me.
Jason Johnson. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so there's five. So a lot of devs from The Force Unleashed have moved on, and Matt has started this incredible company. Which can you say now, kind of where it's at in the process, or?
A bit. I can say that we are still going through some very rigorous clinical trials, which is super exciting with the game, and we are learning a ton from that, adjusting the game, and we're actually pretty close to buttoning up a version that we're going to put into. A very, very large trial that's run almost exactly like a drug trial in a way, to kind of be the nail in the coffin on what we have and whether or not it works the way that we expect and think that it does. So really, really exciting times coming up for us right now.
So for all of you that are watching the stream, a lot of devs from The Force Unleashed have moved on to do some really, really cool stuff. Matt, what Achilles is doing is just super exciting to me, obviously, but I just thought people would find it incredible because it's just taking games into a new and extremely helpful and potentially revolutionary, if I may use such a big word, direction, you know. And there are devs that are working, like Hayden's at Hangar 13 doing Mafia 3, and there are folks at Crystal Dynamics, there are folks at Santa Monica Studios, there's folks at Naughty Dog, like Brian Reckonwald, and I mean, there's folks all over the place doing really, really incredible stuff, and for those of you that are listening, it just, you know, it really was such a talented group of people assembled to make this game, and everyone had just incredible passion, and it was, challenging. Yeah,
the challenge, and I think the talent and the creativity was unmatched, and maybe even to this day, and that entire team between designers and engineers and obviously audio, all these things were just a perfect storm in the best way of these just incredibly talented and creative people. But as you point out, the passion for what we are doing, the passion for Star Wars, the let's do the impossible, all that combined, absolutely one of my favorite experiences in life in general. And I would note too, it's probably my number one favorite thing of all of Force Unleashed was that I met my wife on Force Unleashed.
Yes.
Yes, and we both had sworn off never ever date anyone we'd ever worked with, had never done that to that point. We met each other. It was over. It was right at the beginning of Force Unleashed. We met each other. We were secret for about a year, and then we kind of
Matt, we all knew. Yeah. We all knew.
Yes. Yes, we all knew.
Oh, yeah, probably.
We all knew.
We all just pretended. Yeah. You know. Yeah. No.
But yeah, it's crazy. We met at the beginning of Force Unleashed, and we got married right as we were crunching at the end of Force Unleashed 2, which was terrible timing on our part. But and now we have two beautiful daughters, and two brand new Star Wars fans who will probably be fans of Episode 22.
Exactly. No choice as far as them becoming Star Wars fans. You just kind of issue them their fanship membership.
Correct. So yeah, great. Well, I do have to go here in a few minutes. But if there's any other specific questions anyone had or anything else you guys wanted to chat about, I can probably do about 5 more minutes.
Let's do some questions.
Yeah, if there's any more questions here, trying to see if there's
no sign
any
of any dispute.
So I can think of.
We're already light years away from any Imperial forces.
Yeah.
It takes them a second to catch up with us. So
yes.
If you guys have any questions for Matt Omernick,
we have the entire galaxy in front
Omernick.
Of us.
Omernick.
And yet.
Yeah, why
for the
did
first
I call
time
it?
In my
what?
Life.
Who are you?
That's David. I'm just Matt O. That's why. No
Matt O. He says I just called you Matt O. David Collins.
We need to
David
rally the Emperor's enemies.
Collins.
Witwer.
Witwer, which, by the way, Filoni every now and then still calls me Sam Witwer, which I think is his whole wolf thing. Wit the Witwer.
And I think I know.
How was it decided what Jedi went into this game?
General Kota?
Was it decided what Jedi?
Yes. Which Jedi, like Shaak Ti or...
When I fought him, he said it'd be part of
my
future.
Good question. Yeah, I mean, I think, David, between you and I, we could probably half field that, but that's
right.
For sure
a
Hayden Guru question more so. But, I mean, a lot of it was what made sense for the canon at the time, who was around, and I think more so... we invented Kazdan Paradis, so we had the leeway to actually create New Jedi, which, also one of the most amazing opportunities in a lifetime.
Yeah.
But it was a combination of things that just Princess what Leia. Slotted in of existing senatorial canonical Jedi and what you know what Captain we felt Stern. We wanted to create we to highlight and you know highlight hostage. Using the Force to in an extreme way. From
out hey, we have Empire. A question for Matt.
Understand the situation, Senator.
Hold on, we'll wait
if
for Tom Kane to
keep his mouth shut.
By the way, this
I'll
is Tom Kane, the
way.
Voice actor, very if famous not, voice actor, but that is also his likeness.
You'll become the
yeah, that's Tom's face and his voice. But Tom reminds us they didn't use his eyes. Tom has blue eyes.
Show me to my quarters.
Tom is
as you wish.
The announcer in the Clone Wars, and he's that's also right. Yoda.
He's Yoda. And all kinds of stuff.
So Matt,
we didn't use his blue eyes because I wanted enemies to just pop out in front of him. to desaturate him.
Right. No, that's a good point. Matt, what was a good example of blending the prequel and the original trilogy looks in this game?
The most. Overt one was I think that maybe stormtrooper design that you guys called
General
out.
Coda.
As simple as that seems, it took us a lot of time to really kind of nail and gun that, and we felt that was one of the first things that we did to try to visually bridge the trilogies. And I think once we got happy with that balance,
not exactly, but I think we can help each other.
Surprisingly, drove a lot, or it kind of outlined a lot of the range that we wanted to stay within.
I don't
and some of the other examples, I mean, the Rogue Shadow was a really great example of that, I think. A brand new vehicle, of course.
The Empire wins, boy.
It was also this nice blend of mostly something from the Empire, clearly, right? A lot of the elements are built there, too, but it also had Rebellion shapes. And so we were mixing not only the trilogies, but with Starkiller as a character who was going to transition in this game, we tried to actually blend... kind of both sides of the battle into some of these designs as well. So there's a lot of that. We, you know, every major element in the game, there was a lot of thought that went into how we bridged those two trilogies. Because they're visually, obviously, very different.
Pretty distinct, yeah.
That's a good one, yeah.
How much freedom for creating these different aspects of the world and decorations, and were there things that you could not put in terms of details and such, that you wish you could have?
Ah, wow. So Lucasfilm Licensing was really supportive and really had our back as we designed a lot of this. So I felt like we had a lot of creative license in what we made. But there's always something that you just don't expect that comes out of left field all the time. And it's usually something small and unusual. I'm trying to think of a couple of good examples where we did something really crazy that we thought was going to get spit back out, and they'd say, "No way, you're nuts," and that would pass. But then we would, have, I don't know, a certain color of a tiny insignia that you would never see on a game on someone's chest, and they'd come back and be like, "There's no way you can do that. That's totally wrong."
Wow.
Which was awesome. But there's not a lot of like majorly specific examples that come to mind right away, but a lot of back and forth, but licensing was very, very supportive and helpful in helping us design it. You know, I think a lot of it was, again, the team's love and knowledge of Star Wars from Hayden on down. That's what gave us that license, right? I think that team had proven themselves as really knowing and loving and executing well on Star Wars.
That's awesome.
What else we got? In terms
I'm
of questions?
Looking for another question for. Can I scroll up here?
Yeah, go for it.
Scroll up here.
Oh, poor Coda! Look at this. Poor but he's General a break Coda. Dancer. Look at him. Whoa! Look at this. Look, David, you're missing it.
Oh what? Oh nice.
He's fighting back. He's fighting the Empire,
yeah, the
even in midair.
Yeah, they're floating through space.
You got him. See, Rose, and that's how we defeat our enemies.
Rose, I need you to hang on, Rose. Jack, don't wait, Jack.
It's a different
My heart will go on.
Let's see. For Matt, what was a good example of blending? Oh, is there any other? What was a good example of blending? You already said that one. Sorry. Let's see. Maybe I should pay attention to what I'm doing here. Yeah, Force Unleashed 3 question. I'm failing miserably, you guys. Here Sam is talking, doing his stuff at the same time. My job is to sit here and scroll, and I'm just doing terribly at this. I got to scroll back up and see there were a ton of questions up here. So I'm scrolling through here.
By the way, I love these Imperial gunships that you built, Matt. These are they're sort of the evolution of the Clone Wars gunships.
We have a problem here. Imperials are everywhere.
What can you set down?
Here, you might want to scroll down and see if any new ones came in. They started asking questions.
Well, every time it just like pops back down.
What is the hardest level to design? See,
that took
you
3 seconds.
Yeah, don't worry.
What was the hardest level to design?
Yeah, the hardest level. I think artistically, Felucia was the most challenging. And then, you know, from a game design point of view, that one's up in the air. They were all really tough. You know, we had an incredible design team, and dealing with all these new physics, and you know, it's a melee game, and it's a range game, and it's an environmental puzzle game, and it's so much. So you know, every level was very complex. But yeah, artistically, I can definitely speak. You know, for the art team, it's, you know, Felucia was, you know, scary and challenging and cool, but we took it on, and I think it came out great.
By the way, one of the game applications of that tech demo, I remember the Jar Jar in Carbonite in the tech demo that went from being this sort of like granite, and just in a debug menu immediately switched it to jelly. Do you remember that?
Wow.
Saw that application in Cloud City where you take a Carbonite tube and you spray it on a Stormtrooper. The Stormtrooper turns to Carbonite. You force push and it breaks into pieces.
Right.
That's a perfect example of that tech demo being exploited in gameplay that I just loved in this. Which brings me to a question that I do remember on here from earlier, which is, why didn't DMM catch on in more games after Force Unleashed, in your opinion?
It certainly caught on when it came to movie applications.
In movies, yeah, it was everywhere.
In
yeah.
film all the time.
Simulations, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That is a great question, and I don't have an answer.
I guess
I haven't.
Speculate,
I have not
right?
since worked on it. Yeah, yeah. And I mean, I have not worked on a game outside of LucasArts that either maybe investigated it or not. I don't know. I really don't know. It's a great question. If I had to speculate, I would say that it's a lot of work. It's a tremendous amount of work, and it's a completely. It puts game designers in a whole new state where they have to be thinking about their design and their puzzles in an entirely new way. So I think maybe just because it's kind of scary new territory, and technically getting it integrated is a challenge from a performance point of view, or at least for us at the time. So just a lot of barriers for entry would be my speculation. But it's tough to say. Yeah, I wish I would see it more. I absolutely love it.
Yeah.
It's so much fun.
Yeah, Euphoria was in the Grand Theft Auto game, and it's. You think Euphoria is it still around? Are people using it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it made it into I think it was Madden or NCAA. I can't remember. Used it a lot in some sports games, and yeah, Euphoria's done some great stuff, and they've actually created their own game studio. Natural Motion, the company that created
right.
Euphoria, has their own game studios. They've created. They actually created a Jenga game on the iPad, which is super fun, where it's just using a great physics engine where you're actually rotating around a 3D Jenga stack and pulling stuff out. So they've done some really cool stuff and continue to.
Do you have time for two more, Matt?
Sure.
Yeah, I'll do it.
Yes.
We'll do this really, really quickly. Hardest character in the game to design. Character in the game to design? Yeah.
Wow. I would, if I had to pick...
right.
I would say maybe Kasdan Pratis. For a few reasons. One, that he was new, right? He's a brand, you know, brand new character, which has its own set of challenges. You got a lot of Star Wars to live up to. He's got to fit and he's got to feel right. But the fact that he was, you know, small in stature and an alien and unusual looking, you know, getting that to feel believable, and then on top of it his crazy spider leg rig, right? So when you take into account designing the character, animating all these different aspects where you're dealing with something that's part mechanical and part flesh, and then from the game designer's point of view, how does that guy move and how do you fight him? There's a lot of complexities in a character like that.
Right.
So on one hand, Kasdan was one of the most difficult, but on the other hand, you could say Sam or Natalie, you know, bringing in, you know, Starkiller or Juno, where these are pivotal emotional characters, and you have to, from an art point of view, you know, capture that likeness and deliver on that likeness to the best of your ability, and you're deep in the uncanny valley, which is a place you should just never go in computer graphics, right? But we're deep in it, and So that's a completely different kind of challenge where it's like, oh man, these, we have to do this justice. We have to make sure that these emotions and that these actions are portrayed and believable and do evoke emotion in the player and tell the story. So that's a lot of pressure, and that's really hard to design characters that can deliver on that.
And then just last question, was there anything that you were designing at the beginning that got cut? Like we talked about, I mentioned that I think there was a crystal planet at one point in development. Were there anything that got cut that you worked on that you wish would have stayed in the game?
That was Haroon. Haroon was the name of the crystal planet.
That's right.
Yes.
That's right.
And that was Michael Kawas, our lead environment artist. In addition to managing a giant team of artists, he built Haroon and never saw it the light of day.
He built it like in Xeno? He built it in the engine?
Absolutely, yeah. It was playable level. Could run
there's
around
a it, lost yeah. Force Unleashed level on some hard drive somewhere.
There you go. So yeah, there were things like that. I think because we had such a strong leader in Hayden, and we had such a strong story, again, from Hayden, and we had such strong direction for this game and such strong support from LucasArts and Jim Ward and Peter Hirschman and all these guys, we were able to plan pretty well, and we were able to move forward smartly and build the right assets and give them the attention that they needed. And so there was very few wasted assets in the game compared to other games that I've worked on. And again, a lot of that credit just goes to, you know, strong leadership, strong vision, and passion to execute on this stuff. So not a lot.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's great. This has actually been fun for me to hear you talk about this.
Sure.
Stuff.
Yeah, Matt, you've been awesome.
Matto, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, guys. This is so much fun. And thanks, everyone, for coming out.
Yeah.
Cool.
Thank you, everyone, for your cool
Thank
questions.
You guys for doing this. Don't ever stop, and whenever you want me back, let me know.
Sure. Oh, that would be fun. It would be fun to have you back on, and we'll continue telling lies.
Some slander.
That you can correct. Anyway, yeah. Thanks again.
Cool. Thanks, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye.
All right, take
Thank
care.
Thank you, man. Bye-bye. See you later, buddy.
It just occurred to me we could take these off.
Can, I suppose you're right.
But I guess this you're is right. kind of nice to... Wait.
No, but it's so much nicer to do this instead. Yes. I'm getting killed, actually.
You've been doing very well in this game.
Do you want to drive at all?
Yes and no. Like, I think it's fun, but it's been so long since I played this game. If you think there's entertainment value in watching me suck so bad...
Go.
No.
Go.
Okay, do I even remember how to play this game? I do, sort of. Wait, there's my dash. What am I doing? What are my... these guys. Yeah,
it's
not really. Do I want to play this game? Sure. All right.
Perfect. Have you played this for Lauren, your wife?
We haven't gotten, I think, to this quite yet. We've been talking... I think I played a little bit of 2, no. I've played a lot of that sort of stuff, but she is actually watching.
Watching.
Yeah, she's been
that's
watching.
Awesome. She's very patient.
She's at home watching. Very patient. She watched all 2 hours last time, which
that's
is cool.
That's awesome.
Are there snipers?
David, what?
I see snipers. What? You,
for you.
You go. Maybe you go,
yeah,
too.
Yeah.
Both of you guys. And you... Fine. Bye.
Those Ugnaughts are getting in the way of your physics sandbox fun. What... For you, I mean, I know that Republic Commando, for example, was a big moment in your career because that was the first time that you were the lead sound on a project. But
yes.
So how would you define Force Unleashed when it comes to your career?
You know, the Force Unleashed was, I think, like I said last time, it was an incredibly difficult project. I got a sniper over here. I got someone over here. Oh, this guy. Bye. Playing and talking at the same time. Very difficult.
Yes.
It was a pretty big project in my career. I mean, it was, at the time, I think for all of us, it was just the most ambitious thing I think we'd ever done. Republic Commando was, in terms of scale, just to put it in perspective, I mean, I had maybe, there were 3 of us working on it full time, one in sound and one in dialogue, Jesse Carlin and music. And The Force Unleashed was more like, at its peak, probably about 25
sound people, and that doesn't include all of the music people that were doing all the orchestrating and copying, and plus, you know, 100 musicians doing the orchestra. That doesn't include all the voice actors. It doesn't include everyone at Skywalker Sound who helped with the Foley and do all that kind of stuff. I mean, so much. I am sucking so bad.
You are amazing.
No. I just levitated to him.
Oh, to you. You get called. Goodbye. You were one of the chosen.
I was like,
it was the rapture.
I was like,
are you sure you don't want it? You don't want
to? No, you go ahead. Okay. It was a very, very difficult project, and you know, I guess I can share a little bit of a story. So we had, you know, everything was being built internally. We had an internal sound engine, and it just, you know, we had to rebuild the sound engine in an emergency situation because of some bugs that were.
How far ahead of the release was
about
that?
About 6 months before we released. So there was a period of the game where we had to strip out all the sound in the game. And it was to the point where I was playing sounds like QuickTime movies at company meetings to be like, no guys, really, I really am making sounds for this game. Well, not me, but like, you know, our entire team is working really hard to make stuff, you know. And so we're building software to build software.
Oh,
you know?
My God.
And the whole team had those kind of struggles. It wasn't just unique to sound, but and we were hiring people like crazy. I mean, a lot of the Force on Loose team that was so talented, you know, on the sound side, Tom Bryan, Aaron Brown, Damien, a lot of people working on it were new to the company, you know.
And right.
You know, we had to find those people and hire them. Meanwhile, you know, there was a deadline to hit. So all that stuff was going on. Plus new boxes, you know, and
new boxes. Oh,
sorry,
right,
the PlayStation
Xbox
3
and
PS3. Like I mentioned last time, were just very different. So I left feeling like if I could do this, I could figure out anything because it was just really hard. You know, Republic Commando was deeply satisfying professionally, but this was in a lot of ways even more so because it was just so ambitious, and we got it out the door. It was also very personal for me because, you know, you were in it, I was in it as characters,
right.
And so there was a lot of just kind of dream come true type of moments.
Well, it's interesting for me because we've been friends since 2001, and we were, you know, we're both Star Wars fans and such, but sometimes I would talk about something that was happening in Star Wars, and you know, you'd be very patient with me, and you'd be like, yeah, cool, but it was clear that you did that every day. So, you know, on your time off, maybe you didn't want to talk about Star Wars as much because it was like every single waking moment was Star Wars. But I remember feeling the full power of your fanship. The full power of your fandom when we started working on this game. I remember at one point you and I were so giddy and possibly contributing to actor direction a little bit too much.
Dara's like, and then Dara, guys, shut up.
Dara O'Farrell full on just snapped at us. And he had
too
every right
cooks,
to.
Too many cooks in the kitchen.
Way
oh,
too
you
many
know what
cooks.
It should be like this. Oh no, you did it like this. Yeah, we were.
And
we
Dara
were
was like.
Kids on the set.
It was because we were, you know, it wasn't like we wanted to take over. It was simply we were so excited. And Dara was, he very wisely shut us up.
Yes, but in a great way, and then took us out for drinks later.
And then took us out for drinks. Yeah. Well, that was the thing about Dara. You know, any good director, whether it be for any project you're doing, whether theater, video games, movies, they're very patient with the talent because they understand people are, you know, in a weird way, games like projects like this are it's like fantasy fulfillment, and so. What you don't want to do is crush that enthusiasm, because that enthusiasm is going to take you far in terms of getting the performances right and getting the workload all finished up. And, you know, it's just, you don't want to crush it. But at times you do need to drop the hammer because, I mean, you and me were losing our minds.
Yeah,
at least
yeah.
I know I was. Yeah. I was so excited about all this.
Yeah. By the way, I love that those Ugnaughts, they don't care. They're just going to come at you and they're going to... try and take a piece out of you, even though it's like certain doom.
Yeah. Well, they've seen everyone else die, and they know that it's their time.
They're just berserking at you, even though they have no chance.
Yeah.
Absolutely no chance.
This game is about the bravery of the Ugnaught scavengers.
That's what it's actually about. That's the subplot that we were trying.
Did you see how I almost fell off the ledge there and used...
Yes, I did. I'm very impressed.
Yeah.
Very
I do shit like that all the time. I'm sorry. I shouldn't swear on this guy. This is a Star Wars cast. We should not be swearing. I apologize.
No, but I back to the fandom thing. So, I mean, it's interesting what happens when you love something so much, but that thing becomes a source of stress for you.
Yeah.
You know, that because you're talking about it all the time, and And in talking about some of these things, you just start, your mind starts going to, oh, I haven't gotten this done, I haven't gotten that done.
Right.
I've got to, you know, hit this deadline, and oh, how am I going to do that? And that's where my brain went with Star Wars for a long time. And then when it's over, you can kind of pause and really, you can't really make something and reflect on it at the same time when you're kind of in the middle of it. But yeah, it was an incredible project, and yeah, monumental for the company. And so, and I love that, you know, people love it so much still, you know, and it's just this kind of unique moment in time, I feel like, for the company to make something like this, where we've got to make something with all of the key characters and tell a story like this. It's just really super.
I feel like it was an interesting time in Star Wars history too, because the movies were done, George was retiring, and no one really knew what was next, and there was there was a big gap between the two trilogies in terms of what happened in that gap.
Yeah, it was kind of wide open at this point in time.
Yeah.
You know, what's going to happen? It was just, there was a lot of innocence, ironically, that went into this. I think if we knew what we were trying to do, we might not have been so ambitious.
Bold.
If we knew how hard it was going to be, but I know we talk about that a lot. You know, a lot of game developers make games that are difficult, these are our experiences. But someone did ask about Princess Leia, and who voiced Princess Leia?
Cat Tabor.
Cat Tabor had just been cast as Padme Amidala in Clone Wars. And what was neat about Cat was her first voice acting gig. I think Cat's listening, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe her first voice acting gig ever was the first Knights of the Old Republic as Mission Veo.
That's right, she was Mission.
She was Mission Veo, and so, you know, and Dara had cast her as Mission Veo, and, you know, just to tell a little side story, you know, the auditioning process never stopped. We were full in development, and we still needed to find other actors. We needed a 14-year-old Princess Leia.
Mm-hmm.
What does that sound like? So we tried to find a Carrie Fisher, thinking it would be easier to just find someone that had that sort of smoky alto voice.
At 14.
At 14. Well, she probably did, you know. Yeah. And I remember...
It's a funny story, Aaron, boy. The Emperor's army is infinite. You'll eventually be killed or worse, and nothing will have changed.
But wouldn't you rather die on your feet than drown in some cantina?
Which is a great archetype.
I don't know.
If that's a thing. Is that a thing?
I think it's a thing. It's a great
thing. I do
thing
have a contact in the really Senate who could use your lightsaber.
I didn't see the movie.
Where's your ship?
Where's your ship?
Jesse Harlan and Will Roger and Mark Risky were very, very careful. I love this.
I was beginning to worry that you died in your sleep.
I'm starting to wish that I had.
We were having General Coda snoring, so I
so he mic'd himself and went to sleep.
Yeah,
but I still think this mission's too dangerous.
The
planet is completely controlled by the Empire.
I don't know if you're aware how many times I've been
in
your office.
No.
I have many
times. Smuggled me to Cloud
City. Maybe you didn't know that.
He's an old ally to the Jedi Order.
I slept in your office all the time. I would be. See, you may have even been there because I'd be under. I'd be so. I would wedge myself between some of your speakers behind your desk.
Oh, I
just pass out.
Because
it was
so quiet
in
there. It was very
patience, boy.
Until I started making explosion sounds.
That's right. That wasn't quiet.
No.
But yeah, the music editors functional. Kept track of
and take us down.
Of what pieces of John Williams they used where, and were very, very careful about how they paced it out. You probably heard a lot of Empire Strikes Back in the Cloud City level.
Right.
That's all very, very intentional, and something that Jesse took very deep pride in doing.
Mm-hmm. So what am I looking for, General?
Here you are.
Kashyyyk.
The Empire has completely decimated it.
Yeah, look at this place.
But back to Princess Leia, I remember, you know, we auditioned a lot of girls for that role. That we're trying to do the same thing, find someone that looked the part, and I will never forget, you know, going, Princess Leia, it is an honor to meet a senatorial observer in an audition, and this, I don't know, she must have been maybe 11 or 12. She was like, if you had a piece of paper, you can drop the charade, Captain Stern. I had about it, and I was just like, oh no, this is a miscalculation. We had a whole.
This is a miscalculation.
We had a whole day of that. And Dara, the thing about Dara is he's so nice. He's so nice in audition situations. He's like, good, on the button. And he's in the booth, right? Why don't you do it again? This time maybe try and, you know, bring a little bit more calm naturalism to it, you know. And I remember I would turn and look in the glass where, you know, the actor couldn't see me. I'm like, what are you doing? Like, just say, thank you, you know. But he couldn't do it. He was so nice that he had to read everyone the same amount
yeah.
of time.
Dara's great.
I was like, "What are you doing? I'm. This is like torture." But he was so nice about it. He didn't want to hurt. He didn't want to hurt any. He didn't want to hurt any young girls' feelings. What if they potentially become Star Wars fans? And I understand it now. But at the time, I was like, "Dude, why are we reading this again? This is not gonna work." Drop the shred, Captain Stern. We had that same thing when
take the gum out of your mouth, please, and let's try this again. Yeah.
Well, the same was true with before we cast Natalie was, you know, we went to London and we were casting a lot of actors. You're auditioning a lot of actors for Juno. And we got a lot of this sort of thing. Felucia in range. So now I led the Battle of Caledonia. I can't do that accent. I think I just went Australian. But it was very like, it was very Cockney or very sort of EastEnders, you know?
Right, right.
And Natalie came in and she had this very sort of posh, you know, almost like looking down her nose at me a little bit. Like she was able to be this kind of like regal, almost imperial officer. She could turn that on. You know?
Well, Natalie has that too in life. She kind of knows how to, you know,
make you
step out of the setup straight.
Let's be proper right now.
Are we being idiots?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It's that accent, you know, and she's able to sound very, very proper that way and turn that on. But, also, you know, had a great sense of humor about Star Wars and just really worked well for the role. But yeah, there were some times in casting that was just like, that's not it. Kat Tabor, we played obviously with her as Princess Leia because we're kind of going for, well, maybe her voice was different when she was a kid. And Kat kind of used the lower register, and the fact that she was Padme, I just thought that was kind of a nice.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and she's supposed to be 14, so she can sound a little bit different.
And there's a nice consistency there with the Clone Wars, like where you know, the division's playing well together. And it's one of the things we love about Dave Filoni is he's always trying to get the divisions trying to get the divisions to work together and honor those things.
I wanna point out though that I was the one that said to Dara O'Farrell, I'm like, get Kat Tabor, she's Padme. I made the same argument to him.
Oh.
So as far as I'm concerned, Kat, if you're listening. You're welcome. Right?
That's right. That's right.
Because that's it did actually happen. I did actually say it. That should go down.
Oh, good cutscene.
Here we go. Here we go.
What's that insignia there?
Strange. Coda, I think I found something.
What?
That's a lot of plushy.
Just an old hut, but
on your
it feels
yeah
familiar.
A lot of belts.
I feel great darkness here. And sadness.
Turn away. Get on with your mission. There are some things you aren't ready to face.
What's inside?
Well, how should I know? My link to the Force has been cut. But if you go inside, you'll face whatever's in there alone.
I never wanted this for you. I never wanted any of this for you.
I'm sorry, son.
Again, that's that pickup we were talking about. Yeah. I'm sorry, son. I'm sorry,
wait,
Jacob.
Father, no! I remember reading against,
Juno to Starkiller. Are you all right? We lost contact with you for a moment.
I'm fine, Juno. I'm just a little bit turned around.
Well, I'm picking up a major Imperial facility right in front of you. Whatever you're looking for is likely to be inside.
What was that you were going to say?
I remember reading against the guys they were auditioning for my dad. And, some of them were pretty good, but there was the same thing of like, not everyone can do Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there were guys like, never wanted any of this for you. Never wanted any of this for you. I'm like, no, you're a Jedi. Yeah, what are you doing? I mean, that was one of the things that we talked about is that if you watch Mark Hamill. He was one of the Marx brothers, and he was originally cast as Luke, but then they're like, you know, it's not a comedic thing.
No. It's too Marxist.
Mark Hamill obviously has a great vocal facility, and he knows what he's doing with his voice, and he did when he was younger, too. Ah, Flame Troopers. Ah. Wow. Red Armor. Where have we seen those?
Red Armor, Flame Trooper.
Where have we seen those? And it's just interesting.
It's interesting, isn't now. It?
Yeah.
Oh, these guys making an appearance on
December 17th. Aren't they in The Force Unleashed? I mean, The Force Awakens? Oh. No, dude. By the way, we could not be more excited for what they have in store for us. We're so...
The Force Awakens is just like...
My God.
It's made me like a little kid.
Again. Yeah. Yeah.
That's one of the things about, you know, working on this kind of stuff is, at the end of the day, like, it's just, I just felt like it was really important to be a huge Star Wars fan and just love Star Wars. Otherwise, how can you, you know, how can you put everything you have into it? And, you know, I still, after working on literally dozens of Star Wars projects and games, I just still love this franchise so much.
Yeah.
It hurts sometimes, especially when I'm watching that, like, that new TV spot that came out today, you know, the Rey TV spot.
Oh, yeah, that was incredible. That was great. So one of the things that, when we were shooting Force Unleashed, that we talked about was that the closer a character gets to the Force, the better it is to adapt a more neutral dialogue, right? Because it's...
Ah, yes.
You can have Luke Skywalker saying, "The Force?" with a hard R, or the Force.
Yeah.
And you can have that before he knows the Force.
Right.
But if you notice in Return of the Jedi, it's the Force.
The Force.
The R has been it's a little bit mid-Atlantic. It's a little bit old style.
He
it's not British.
Much. He knows too much and he sees too much, and now he hears his own colloquialisms and regional accent.
That's right.
Accent.
And it's not British. It's closer to what they would call standard American stage speech. But we did something similar with Starkiller, is that when he's talking to Darth Vader, it's, you know, "What is your will, my master?"
Very noticeable in that opening scene.
Yeah.
And then because you turn up Proxy, I heard you, you know.
Exactly.
You became very casual, and it actually serves as kind of a note to the audience of like, okay, well, this is a downbeat.
He's standing on ceremony.
You can relax here.
And then when he's standing on ceremony with Darth Vader, so he's trying to be the ultimate Sith apprentice. And then when it comes to hanging out with Proxy and Juno, then he's just a guy, you know? So it's, "What is your will, my master?" And then it's, "Hey, guys, what are you doing? I just had to talk to my dad, and he's being a dick." So it's one of those things that, you know, and so in the audition process for Force Unleashed, when we were trying to find people to do this stuff, not everyone understood that. I mean, some of these guys you could have hired for, you know, a lot of different parts in this, but... when it came to playing a Jedi, the father of this character, you know, you couldn't have a guy going, "I never wanted any of this for you, man."
Yeah.
You know, like, it didn't work. He was, you know, he's a monk, samurai, space wizard. Yeah. So there's got to be some classical
elevated
feeling, an elevated language. You know, it doesn't have to be British, but it's got to have. You can't sound like he's from, you know, Encino or something.
So,
I'm just sorry. I'm so sorry. dude, I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry.
You just got pitted. It's so pitted.
Oh, dude. Yeah, you can't have that with a Jedi. And away with you! Oh. Yeah, just how many, like, backs broken in this game?
So many.
Too many. Oh, no, he fall. But yeah, do we have any other...
Let's see if there's some questions here. Questions.
No, but go away, my friend. Sleep.
Also, Carrie Fisher has an English accent in it.
Well, okay, so I want to defend Carrie Fisher, because a lot of people are like, her accent's in and out with that. But it's the same... Yeah, it's the same thing. When she's
putting on diplomatic speech.
When she's doing...
Natalie Portman did the same thing.
That's the same thing. It's like when she's with Tarkin and Darth Vader, it's Darth Vader. Only you could be so bold. And then when she's with the boys, it's... Well, when you came in, you didn't have a plan for getting out? You know, that kind of thing. And that made sense to me. I think some people are not, you know, not really understanding the actor choice there. Because she's a senator. She can't, She can't go in and say, Darth Vader, only you could be so bold. It doesn't work. Yeah. You know, and
really, Vader, only you could be so bold.
Oh my God, Vader, have
you're
you met?
You're killing me right now.
Oh,
Vader.
You're killing me. I'm tired of this. Let me go. Can't do that.
Yeah, Commodore Tarkin. I thought I recognized that swamp ass when I came on board. Yeah.
Holding Vader's leash. You know, you can't really do that. You have to have an awareness, and frankly, that's where classical training helps you. Theater training. Not that you have to have classical theater training and voice and speech to be an actor. There's all kinds of different actors, but if you want to be in a Star Wars thing or something that feels timeless, you have to know how your voice is coming across. I think.
Holocron. Let's see if there's another question here.
God, Matt Omernick just trashed this place. Look at this. Look what he did. Really no did. Respect.
He really did.
No respect.
Was the story for The Force Unleashed, developed by Hayden Blackman, well adapted by Sean Williams to the novels? How faithful were the novels to Hayden and the team's original ideas? I think they were pretty darn faithful. They were in simultaneous development, and that's really kind of a Hayden question, so maybe I should stop on that.
No, I think that you should answer and then have Hayden...
Well, I told Sean that there was a whole scene in the game where Proxy... killed Starkiller.
That's right.
And basically ran off
with Juno.
With Juno. Mm-hmm. And you know,
because he could be any man that she could ever dream of.
That's right. And so Proxy, you know, turned into Han Solo.
That's right.
And it was a great scene. And
good
Hayden
scene.
Stepped in
strong
and
scene.
Ruined it, quite frankly.
Hayden ruined a lot of things.
He did.
Including the casting.
Including the...
oh, God. He got the wrong guy!
No, but yeah, the Sean Williams novel. And I remember, you know, being very proud seeing that hardbound novel in bookstores and going and buying it, even though I could have just had gotten one. I actually went to the store and was like, you know. And I think the novel was like a New York Times bestseller.
It was.
And really, really, really cool.
That was one of the things that we just kind of... when this all came out, it just all went really well. That was one of the fun things about this is that we had this. There are times where you're doing a project and you're having a really great time making it, and you have hopes for it. And you're like, oh, this is so great, and the people are so great, and this is great, great, great. And then it comes out, and it's just either not what you expect or it doesn't really go well. It's not received well. Mm-hmm. And this was a situation where it was just received really well, and that felt really good. I mean, as I've said to you, since this game came out, there isn't a week that goes by where someone doesn't ask me about Force Unleashed, which is just astounding.
Like you'll be at a con or something like that.
Or even on the street.
Even on the street.
Even on the street. It's part of the, I guess it goes along with looking like the character.
Yeah.
It's a very strange thing.
Yeah, and you know what's great too? It's Celebration. The Celebration Anaheim. Huge Force Awakens moment. Kathy Kennedy, J.J. Abrams, everybody. John Boyega comes out on stage. And he's like, oh, I love Star Wars. Are you kidding me? The video games? Force Unleashed? What's up? And I just, like, swelled with pride. And that was actually kind of an emotional moment for me. Because I'm like, Bob Iger's in the audience. You know, that's huge. I'm just going to put that rock right up there.
It's just,
I just want to put that rock right up on the shelf.
It would look better there aesthetically. I'm trying to give it a natural feeling.
I enjoy a good shelf rock.
Well, a shelf rock.
It's one of my passions. I'm an interior decorator. So John Boyega doing that was really, it was very meaningful. Because here we are, you know, looking at a new era of Star Wars. And it's sort of an acknowledgement of where we've been and how it informs where we're going. It's just really... It was really cool for...
It's nice to be acknowledged as a link in the chain.
Yeah, and it's nice that so many Force Unleashed developers are still working on Star Wars, you know. In a lot of capacities, you know. Rebels and Battlefront, and of course all the team members that were on... Clone Wars and all kinds of stuff. You know, it's still really cool.
It was a special project, and we all just
That was the other, we all just really had fun. It was just so much fun.
Here's a question for you, Sam. How often do you get asked about being a dead tank pilot in the Walking Dead?
Not as often as I get asked about Starkiller, but I do get asked about it.
About as often as I get asked about being a dead, which is never.
Yeah, well, it's a strange question to ask someone. Be like, you know, why would you ask anyone that? Ever. It's... Here, hold on. Let me just torture this guy. Oh. Here, can you give me some breakdancing music?
Yes.
Oh. Oh man, this guy doesn't want to dance. Why does he not want to dance?
You mean like that? That kind of.
Yeah, that was what I was looking for. You know what's David and I came up with lyrics for the Force Unleashed.
That's right.
Did we
you
sing?
You were doing the falsetto like. And it was like very lounge singery. You know?
Do you want to? Shall we?
Oh sure.
Okay, all right. Is that a good key? Is that a good key?
That is the key.
Okay. And it's me scatting, by the way.
And then it was like,
killer.
Something about
your first unleashed. Yes, you are Starkiller. Oh yeah.
Get out of my desk.
Exactly. I forgot that part. That was easy to get around.
You know, and Hayden ruined that too because
he really
I wanted to put that in the game
during during the last level.
That's when I realized that no one listens to me when I'm drunk, and
and that you had an alcohol problem.
Yeah, yeah.
That's when you realized.
It's away. What is my theme song? I've got an idea for Hayden. Let's put a Dubak singing Force Unleashed into the game. It's going to be fantastic.
Here we go. You ready? Check this out.
Yeah. You are Force Unleashed Starkiller.
Thank you.
That was so good.
Oh, God.
So let's look at all the Easter okays. So there's
look at this.
Reek and Rockley and Nexu. What is that?
What is that?
Dude
back? No, it's a man. It's a big man. What is that on the wall on the right?
Oh, Jar Jar.
Jar Jar. And the Kowakian monkey lizard.
Kowakian monkey lizard? Where?
He's right next to Jar Jar.
No, that's a dino.
No, but look.
See? To the left. Oh, there it
is. Yes, there he is.
Right.
I love. Oh, now that is a. I don't know. Funny that.
That's
Bantha horns.
Yeah.
Up above us is.
OPC killer. What is that? No.
Got a whale of a tale to tell you, lad. A whale of a tale or two. Of the flapping fish and the girls I love. Sorry, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. I don't know why I'm thinking about sea monsters. That was a really weird. Just like.
Wow.
I apologize,
that was amazing.
Guys. There was no need for that. There was no need for that. Oh, this guy, you know what? We should let this guy out. Hey, buddy. You're
come
free.
Out.
Come on out.
I'm free.
He's really about those bars, though.
Joey, stop. But what are you doing over there? Yeah, this way.
I'll just break every bar.
See, you have a lightsaber that you aren't going to be able to just cut those without basically
without killing him.
Down.
Okay,
you,
well, listen.
Can you grip him out of there?
Yes, I can grip him to freedom. My friend. Yes, Wookiees are.
Break the returns!
Oh,
I'm getting down.
We were a little bit more gentle with the Wookiee than we would be.
Yeah.
By the way, just in case Hayden Blackman is listening, you understand that the mockery is just so we get you on.
Just so we have a campaign.
We do.
We have a change.org campaign to stop Sam and David from talking about The Force Unleashed without Hayden Blackman present.
And besmirching.
100,000 have signed the petition so far.
Force for
Most
change.
Of that is me and Sam.
Hey, this is... Yeah. Dude, this is the guy from the Ewok Adventure.
From the Ewok Adventure, yes.
Look at this guy.
Holy crap.
Whoa, the Gorath or something? The Exo-Gorath?
I don't know.
Oh,
good call.
Oh, my God. I'd never seen that before.
Me neither.
Well done, dev team. You've done it again.
That's right.
All right, so here we go. Here we go. Let's go deal with the lady.
This is actually an interesting cinematic. I remember...
I should have expected the Emperor would send an assassin. It's a coward's tactic.
It's just deliver plot. How do we make these interesting? This here with
Master
Coda.
Master
Coda
is dead.
And it seems obvious.
Killed
now,
above Nar Shaddaa.
Looking at it, but
my father.
We together,
your father
really wasn't. But you'll notice
he's
that R2 is constantly providing
contact. How long has your father been feeding Coda information about
and the
imperial targets?
Actually finally how do you know? Worked when
because
R2
Master Coda survived, and he was
like right
sent
here.
To find you. Let's go.
I cannot leave
you know,
while this
just,
planet is still enslaved.
Like R2 protests, you know, the let's go.
If you are truly
R2 is
a Jedi,
constantly giving commentary.
Then you will destroy
reason,
that.
Just adding him
once
to the
that
scene,
Skyhook
the
is complete,
like
the
Star
Empire
Wars
will
and,
start shuttling Wookiee slaves
but
into space.
It seems obvious now, like I said, but it's not in the script.
Entire villages will be taken off world in a matter of days.
Until there was that opening shot.
The Empire will just rebuild it.
Eventually, maybe.
And just made the scene kind of come along.
But you will give the Wookiees a chance to disappear.
We have a question here. Why is Leia such a dick to everyone who tries to save her?
It will be crawling with Imperials.
I don't know.
What about you?
Is there still an Imperial transport on the landing platform?
I'm kind of a psychopath in this game.
You yes,
are.
But I
mean,
think the
probably
might be
heard
dead.
The noises you came in.
Yeah.
What is
and
he doing?
You think
what's going
pilot?
On?
I'm
gonna
be,
is there a dance party?
I'm gonna be a dick to that guy.
Yeah. That guy's... he's asking
know,
for
I
it.
Found what we're looking for.
Excellent. I can be at the drop-off point in.
No, you're not exactly making subtle entrances.
I need to disable the Skyhook before we
no.
leave.
No.
I don't suppose I could talk you out of that.
I love this giant... Look
probably
at this.
Not.
The barbed wire.
Right.
Yeah.
Well,
the giant barbed wire.
Yes.
This planet has giant monsters barbed wire. Do I have a future in projects in the DC Comics universe? I'm certain
I'm
I do.
Picking up Imperial chatter. You've got snipers in the nests above you.
In fact, I'd say I probably don't.
That was quite a journey you took.
You like that? Yeah, it was depressing, man, to learn all those things and have that moment
that
where I realize
yeah.
I'm not, you know,
you
this
know
is
what?
Not going to happen.
Actually, I'm Batman. Oh,
oh
but I just
no.
remembered that I'm not.
I'm not playing that role currently, and probably ever. But I would do it because I'd like to do that.
Are you having dreams about the Force Awakens?
Honest
question. Sorry, totally unrelated. But I've been having dreams. Like I remember before the Phantom Menace came out, I had a dream that I didn't like it, and it really bugged me. And then now I've been having all these weird dreams, and I'm watching it and being like, I'm creating all these crazy stories. Like I keep dreaming that I've seen it. Is that a little obsessive?
Well, that's the thing. You know, the Star Wars dreams that I've always had before the movies always make. No sense.
No sense.
So you wake up in the morning going, it was terrible. Like you'd have like a moment where you're like, there was a
Did
really cool space
that?
Battle. Yeah. And but then this Tauntaun looked at the camera with George Lucas's voice and said, so what did you think about that?
So in this scene, I really wanted to ride in the snow and not get cut open this time.
He started explaining the scene. It was, why would the Tauntaun do that?
George and I were talking about it.
Right, having a Tauntaun.
A talking Tauntaun. Right. He actually changed the name to a Talk Talk.
Right. You know what's funny? What we're doing right now, and the audience doesn't realize this, but what we are doing now, we would never have thought to do a few short years ago when you know.
Well, okay, as Star Wars fans, we probably watched about a million hours of behind-the-scenes special
Documentaries
of George R.
Rick McCallum. Brother of Rich McCallum.
Yeah, brother of Rich McCallum.
Rick McCallum was the producer that George worked with all through Young Indiana Jones, all through the Star Wars movies, all those things. And we've met Rick on a couple of occasions. I believe
he's awesome.
He ate our pizza.
Yes, yes. And that was a Force Unleashed event.
That's right. We were hanging out. I offered it after he stole it. One way of saying it. Like, yes, I did offer it, but it was after he stole it. It was like I went into we were in the main house. We were watching like King of Kong. And we had pizza, and I went back to get pizza, and there's Rick McCallum eating our pizza, and he goes, "Oh, is this yours?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "Oh, I'm sorry," and I'm like, "No." Because you're the producer.
Yeah, and he was nice. He was like, "Oh, cheers, guys. No, thank you."
And
yeah,
he was only like taking one little piece. And
it was
a communal space.
Space. And everyone was like sharing drinks and wine and food.
That's right.
Yeah. Super cool guy. So, but yeah, in all fondness, those impressions come out.
We love to come up with crazy ideas and think about the idea of George and Rick, you know. I don't know.
My favorite was, you know... So I dressed as George Lucas one year for Halloween.
Oh my God! You guys should see this. Can we bring that picture?
Yeah, I'll have to bring that picture. He was so cool about it. He was like, "Your hair's not gray enough, and your shirt's not flannel enough." Like, director just started dressing down my costume, just telling me everything that was wrong with it. But no, he was cool. He's like, "I saw you go up there. I should have tapped you on the shoulder, gone in your place. I could have bumped you a couple of spots in the costume." You know, he was like. Nicest guy about it, you know, and then took a bunch of pictures.
Didn't he take you aside and go, you know,
I work hard. That's what he said. He goes, because he was in the middle of Attack of the Clones, right? He goes, this is like Halloween 2001. He goes, I work so hard, and you get up there and take all the prizes.
That's
and
hilarious.
And I was like, thank you. So I was just so like reverential. I'm like, you know, and people were like, you have balls. Like, what are you doing dressed? I'm like, I don't know, Halloween party, and you... watching all these special features and George Lucas. Anyway, so he was really, really cool, but for the longest time, I would just call Sam and be like, hello, Sam, this is George.
Hey, it's George.
George Lucas.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I would just let it hang.
Yeah, I wasn't expecting this.
You're fired. What? Click. You know, and like, well, because I was expecting to get that phone call myself.
Yeah.
Dressing up.
Well, do you remember, like, for a while, we started leaving, like, threats on each other's answering machine messages? George Lucas, like,
David, your mother sleeps with the fishes if you keep besmirching the company.
Yeah. Exactly.
I'm going to send a couple of guys over.
I paid a guy $400 to break both your legs.
Yeah.
And that's going to happen probably Tuesday.
Yeah, just like,
the nicest, most mild-mannered guy, like, we had fun making him into sort of like a, you know, gangster. I don't know.
Yeah, because it's not who he is at all.
Yeah.
I'm gonna take you out back and work you over, and then
we should maybe I should stop doing that impression.
Probably
for the sake of my career.
Yeah. Well, me too. But you know, it does come from a place of being a tremendous fan
huge,
of that guy. Oh my God.
Fan. Yeah, he's one of my idols.
Well, let's talk about that for a second. Let's talk about this guy who just had some crazy... Look at this. This is really not...
I have a picture of you and me and Dave and Dee Baker and George and Matt Hunter and all at the celebration.
Mm. Yeah, yeah, I have that picture as well.
He was really cool.
But this young guy who just... He just came up with this idea based off of the old Flash Gordon serials, which, by the way, are not in fact very good. This is not like he took source material that was just waiting to be brilliant. I mean, he was really forging something out of really nothing. I mean, his love of film came through, and that was the format that he chose. In fact, his friends, you know, when he said, "Yeah, I'm going to be doing like Flash Gordon type serial," they're like, "Oh." Right, like those dinky little, you know, Saturday morning serials. Yeah, that's a great idea after building this career for yourself and have all this promise. Go ahead, throw it away. Great idea. I should like to arrange a personal meeting. And no one really understood it. And Alan Ladd Jr. and Mark Hamill.
And Mark Hamill.
You know, that's...
It really is.
Well, you know, even Alan Ladd Jr. didn't understand
Give me the history
Star Wars.
Lessons later. But
he admits...
George.
Right, he said, I knew George had talent. I didn't know what the hell he was talking about.
Yeah, and George has said that too. He's like, he invested in me, which, you know, was, you know, very non-studio system. is, you know, invest in the talented person, let the talented person, you know, create a vision. Yeah. That's really, really cool.
Well, and it's from a young age, I know that George Lucas's work has made me want to make things, and that's a powerful influence on a young man's life.
It's also one of those things where the making of it is almost equally as compelling as the actual fiction of it. And I love...
Damn it!
George, why did you not cast me?
That's right. Come on.
Kill
him. He's here.
Oh, did you see that? Boom.
Yeah. Oh, badass Wookiee. This whole section always reminded me of the Republic Commander as well.
Right.
Like, free Wookiees.
Yeah. That's right. That happened in the Republic Commander. Yeah. Wookiees are constantly getting imprisoned in this universe.
Yeah, it's not fair.
No, it's not fair. Yeah. Oh, man. But yeah, he did the impossible. And when I watched that first Star Wars movie, it's just astounding. How do you start with nothing and end up with Star Wars? I mean, most movies would be lucky to have one cool thing that comes away with it, a lightsaber. You know, like, I don't know why I think about this example, but I think of,
awesome.
I think about, Krall. The glaive.
He never used that entire movie until the very end.
And then you realize it's just a boomerang.
I'm just going to go up there and it's just going to spin. Spinny, 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 spinny.
It's a boomerang. But James Horner is telling you it's the coolest thing in the world.
Yeah.
You know, like, most movies have one thing that they hang their hat on. And, you know, Tron had a couple things. Tron had, like, light cycles and you were in the computer and all this cool stuff. Well, George Lucas created a world that had 85 cool things all in one world.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
and they went by like that.
Yeah, C-3PO, R2-D2. Lightsabers, Darth Vader, space wizards, like every iconic element of Star Wars, whole movies are lucky if they have one of those things. And he managed to come up with the whole slew of them. And it's so fascinating to me that when you see kids that are introduced to Star Wars at different from different media, like the Clone Wars, that's Star Wars for some young kids. Rebels is Star Wars for some kids. But they all they all react similarly to R2-D2. Even though he's in these different, maybe he's in a video game, or maybe he's in Rebels or the Clone Wars, and they all have the same love for him that we did when we saw the live-action R2-D2, or Yoda, or there's something that they all tapped into that works across these mediums if you do it right. That was what we were trying to capture some of that magic in the Force Unleashed, trying to create something that is new but still felt familiar, and that, you know, I always get a real kick out of it when someone says to me, oh, you know, I grew up with Force Unleashed, or when I hear someone say Force Unleashed got me into Star Wars. What? How is that even possible? But this always sense.
My one memory of George Lucas I have a couple memories of George Lucas. I remember him being at the launch party and you guys talking, and I just remember thinking, God, I'm watching Sam and George just sit here and chat about stuff.
Nice work.
Jet, actually an intern on the team, huge gamer.
Jet was so young that he was, I believe he was only like 5'11".
Yeah.
He was a tiny little guy.
Very, very, very tall man.
Yeah. He's like 6'3", right?
Yeah. Yeah, huge gamer, huge Star Wars fan, which is awesome.
So cool.
Yeah. Anyway, I remember setting up, there was a pitch meeting that Hayden had to go to, and actually this was in an email conversation with Hayden.
Right.
We did these proof of concept videos, which were really just kind of kick-ass movies. And
some of those made it online, didn't they?
I think some of them did. I'd have to go do a YouTube search, but, you know, a lot of force push, a lot of force grip, you know, this kind of person basically doing exactly what they're doing now. And it was all, you know, pre-rendered, you know, just to show what the game would look like if we went out and built it.
Right. Are you ready,
and
Jedi?
We didn't like the sound system that was in the conference room that we were using at the ranch. I mean, it was great, you know, but it was really more of a meeting room. So I went and set up these speakers right in front of George's, what I was told was George's favorite chair where he always sits. And I set up these two big Genelec speakers and set up this gorgeous monitor and just kind of did our own thing. And Hayden was like, that's when I first learned the term of, you know, speakers pushing air. You know, because that's what's happening is, you know, speakers are actually literally, especially big woofers, are you know, compressing and rarefying air at you,
right,
creating sound. And he said it literally blew George's hair back. a couple of the big, like, low end moments, and I was very proud of that. Even though I wasn't in that meeting, I was there the night before setting the whole thing up, and then waiting with bated breath to hear, you know, whether or not he liked our pitches. And of course he did, which was really nice. But that was a very, very cool moment. It's cool knowing George is here.
I love stuff like this. I grew up with the prequels. I'm currently 13. However, I still own the ABC book based on the objects in the prequels. That's
awesome.
That's just so cool. I mean, when I was... David, when you and me were young men. Do you remember that? When we were young men?
No.
No, do I. But I believe that this happened when we were young men, even though I don't directly remember it. When we were into Star Wars during that time where Star Wars just went away, after Return of the Jedi... And for several years after that, it just was gone.
Yes.
But it was remembered...
The dark period.
The dark times, yeah. And it was... but we remembered it, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, I was a huge... I think I fell away from it for a few years, but I think I got a little older. I got to be like 11 or something. And I was like, yeah, that's for kids, man. Star Wars is for kids. I mean,
right. You
know?
You go through that period of like, I must, you know, sell all of these toys so that, yeah, you know...
This doesn't mean anything to me.
I can learn how to talk to girls. I didn't know what I was thinking at the time. It's like now, you know, I'm an adult and I'm all that. But.
Right. But I remember, like, learning that it was still in my blood when I went to Walt Disney. I guess it was called MGM Studios Theme Park at the time. Which
Star Tours.
Well, yes. And there was so I'm walking through the crowd at MGM Studios Theme Park, which is Hollywood Studios now.
Yeah.
And I see peeking up above the crowd a full-size AT-AT walker. And I remember I was 11 years old. And I took off. I ran. I was like being all cool, and then I saw it. I was like, and I just took off. And I remember slowing down at some point, like, oh, this is not dignified.
Wow.
You know, this is not. You know, but I remember realizing like, oh, this has some sort of impact on me. And then I remember revisiting the movies when I was 13, finally seeing them again, and seeing a whole new layer of sophistication to what those movies were about, and at that point I was like, oh no, I'm hooked.
For me, there were a few things that happened at the same time. Star Tours was great, but for me it was a little later in the early 90s.
That's cool. 22 now, working in a theater almost entirely because of Star Wars.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's so cool.
A couple things happened. The box set came out on VHS. There was a CD box set of John Williams music.
Right, I remember this.
And then Timothy Zahn, Heir to the Empire, came out around the same, but maybe it was a little earlier than that. It was like 91 or 92.
Mm-hmm.
And From Star Wars to Jedi, The Making of a Saga was out on VHS. And then Rebel Assault. Star Wars came out on the Super Nintendo, played it, beat it. Rebel Assault and X-Wing came out. All of those things all kind of happened at the same time, and I was like, whoa.
What's going on? Why are they making Star Wars things?
And it was just like, it all came rushing back, and, you know, and that was just, it's been nonstop ever since.
Well, do you remember, like, let's talk about Rebel Assault for a second.
Yes.
That was, it was a CD-ROM game.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually
one of the biggest reasons for success is that was one of the very first CD-ROM games.
Yes.
And so... it was a huge title for LucasArts, is my understanding. You know, that's what people would talk about when I used to work there, because it was one of the very first CD-ROM titles and sold, you know, a lot of hard drives.
CD-ROM drives. Which computers didn't have standard back then.
You had to buy them, install them. And stuff. And so it was a really big deal, that game. And it was on rails. Well, you know, it was an arcade shooter.
It was an arcade shooter, but it was the most... To our eyes at the time, it looked photorealistic almost. It was almost like, oh my god, this is... The thing that I remember thinking at the time was like, this is new Star Wars footage.
What about the X-Wing and TIE Fighter simulators? It's quite a question. Those were huge, too. I mean,
What game?
X-Wing? Have you heard of this?
No.
Never heard of X-Wing.
No. No. X-Wing. That's weird. Is that a game, or what is that?
Yeah, I guess so.
What's that?
I don't know. It's a box of some kind.
What does it say?
Oh, it
says, X-Wing?
It says X-Wing.
X-Wing?
Swing?
Swing.
Swing.
Yeah, now we're turning
that is very 90s.
We're getting back to the 90s here.
So, yeah, there you go. There you have it. Yeah, I borrowed this from you for an episode of the Comlink.
That's right.
Good old games put it out. You can now get them at GOG.com.
Yeah, thank God they're saving all these old
awesome. Yeah.
But it's, yeah, I remember X-Wing also. It was just like, you're like new Star Wars. I don't get this. What's this was, it was so exciting for me. And, oh, man. You know, West End Games was doing an amazing job of keeping the license growing in a weird way. Because everyone thinks that the Timothy Zahn novels were the beginning of the expanded universe. And not entirely true. The Timothy Zahn novels used the Star Wars role-playing game books as reference. And so those things were, you know, a lot of the ideas that are used in those books were from...
Parallel source book.
Yeah, exactly. Which, by the way...
Which you gifted me once.
I gifted you that, and I gave one to Dave Filoni. When he was
really?
Doing Rebels. Yeah, before he started working on Rebels, I gave him the Imperial source book.
That's awesome.
Which, by the way, has things like Inquisitors and all that stuff.
Speaking of Inquisitors, I actually... The Inquisitor moment was kind of a nice... validation for this game, because I remember when I was making this game and we see those Royal Guard looking guys with lightsabers show up for the first time on Cloud City.
Right.
I remember thinking, well, that's like that's a game thing, like that's kind of breaking canon.
Why are there guys with lightsabers?
And then, you know, and they show up in Rebels, and I was like, oh, well, that's kind of like heartening to know that, you know, that idea was more valid than I originally.
Gave it credit for.
Was concerned about. Gave credit for. But it's really cool. Skyhook should be finished. Yeah, of course the Empire under someone like the Emperor would be having those kind of experiments going on.
Yeah, he would have people that were trained in Force use. They just wouldn't be trained as well.
I mean, a guy that commissions a clone army would probably be doing a lot of crazy stuff.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of those units that are in this game.
Yeah.
The Shadow Troopers. Flame units, and then later on Felicia 2, there's those. What was the story behind those guys? The big heavies.
That
they were like old aberrant.
These guys, those guys.
Those guys, yeah.
The prototype dark trooper type guys. What are they called? Purge troopers. And okay, so Hayden will correct us when he comes on, but as I remember, and maybe I'm wrong about this, or maybe this came about later, but the purge troopers were select clone units, clone troopers, that were getting too old to fight because the clones age twice as fast. And some of them were just decommissioned or went off and, you know, got just, you know, not very good jobs or weren't treated very well. But some of them the Emperor found a use for, which was he cut them up and put pieces of them in the purge troopers. And basically, so they're cyborgs made of pieces of used clones, basically. Like they're men trapped in there, probably living a not very happy life. I love Tom. Let's be civil.
Yeah, it's great.
Now he wants to talk.
Yeah,
he wants to talk.
Way to go. Let those wookies go.
Let my people go. We have any other questions?
Let's see. Any other questions for Sam or about this level or this game? Let us know. Oh, some love for Battlegrounds, Star Wars Galactic Battlegrounds. Worked on that. And we did Empire War later. That character.
Yep.
Hits away.
I actually did that voice for Empire at War.
He was
B-wing. B-wing. Was it a B-wing pilot?
Yeah, it was a B-wing pilot. If you play Empire at War, I think it's the expansion.
Yeah.
I think
the expansion has corruption. That's
yeah.
What it was.
And if you get the B-wings out there,
sitting here going like. Okay, everybody, get ready to start your attack run. Start your attack run on the 7-Eleven.
Sir, are you okay?
Yeah, so just point me to the back refrigerator.
Okay.
Where are the 40s of Michelob?
We're bearing down on the exhaust port, like right
Michelob!
Now.
Michelob!
I just love that he just... All right, we're bearing down on the exhaust port. Cover me, I've got fighters on my tail. Michelob!
Dude, okay, so when they're in the exhaust port, when he goes, you know, the guys are going, almost there, that guy?
Yeah.
It's a different guy. And then, oh, they're right behind me!
That's the same guy.
That's right, that's right later. You know,
But
he's saying, almost there, and there's a guy panicking behind him, like, no, they're right behind me, I can't shake him,
I can't hold him.
He
goes, I can't see it! That's what he does.
That's Biggs.
The same guy?
This guy's like, they're right behind me. I can't hold
them. Oh, that guy.
Almost there.
Watch out for enemy fighters.
And he says,
yeah, that guy.
Doesn't he
say, they've stopped.
Doesn't he say at some point, loosen up? before he dies, which, by the way, I always took to mean loosen up the formation or something. But it's almost like he's telling the guy,
just
like,
calm down.
Dude, calm down. Like, yeah. You're so tense, and that's why you have an alcohol problem.
Yeah, 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 exactly. Loosen up.
Yeah. Loosen up! And then he dies. Yeah. That was his advice.
They've come from behind.
They've come from behind. Yeah, dead. But Porkins, man, that's can't you good pork?
It's all right. It's all right.
I think to answer the question about the Star Wars live action, I don't believe Starkiller was ever going to be a part of that. I mean, these were all very insulated from each other. George was working on the live action while Force Unleashed was being worked on. And while the Clone Wars was getting into gear, and interestingly enough, that's why I was reaching for that.
I'm sorry about that. It's a very sensitive microphone.
That's right. We'll talk like this from now on.
Sorry about that, earbud.
But listen to his soothing voice now. He's learned his lesson.
I'm not actually being a jerk about it.
No, he's not.
I'm trying to be better.
We're not mocking you.
We're being better.
No.
Sorry, you were saying about...
Guys, I think I've missed a holocron on every major level that we've done.
How are we doing on time?
I think we should probably wrap it up. We'll watch the next cutscene. This was the first...
Who was she?
First ever prototype cutscene with a full animation.
Princess
and
Leia Organa. And her father is Bail Organa.
The reason this was used contact is because the there's a lot of subtlety.
I want to talk to him.
In terms of, are you lying?
Well, hold on. Let's.
I just rescued his daughter on a planet overrun by stormtroopers.
You can't talk to him because I can't find him. He's gone missing, boy.
What? When?
Bail tried to recruit me to rescue Leia. I refused, and he went in search of another Jedi, Master Shakti. I told him it was too dangerous, but the fool went anyway. Alone. And vanished as soon as he landed on
Volusia.
The Force is strong in you, my boy. To be able to sense my thoughts.
You're just easy to read, old man.
Well, then you should already know our next mission. We're going to Volusia to rescue Senator Organa.
He has an alcohol problem. Adrian.
Eat up, Senator.
It's a fun Foley moment. That meat.
Why are you keeping me here, Maris? Your master would be disgusted with you.
You're something to trade if Darth Vader finds me. Now shut up and eat.
Jimmy Smith.
And if you're thinking of escaping, just remember that my new pet is very hungry.
So yeah, let's talk about that cutscene.
So let's do that, yeah.
That cutscene, my understanding is, and Hayden will come on here, you know, give you the real story, but my understanding of that cutscene is, the reason we were doing that first is because it's really a true test of fidelity and acting, because it's a really complicated moment, right? Coda doesn't know that that's the same guy he fought at the TIE Fighter construction facility, but he's starting to maybe sense it, and you're kind of like, it's just a very tense moment, and can we pull that off? Was a huge question, and so that's kind of why that cutscene was. I mean, it was the very, very first one where we ever saw you guys in action in the game as a cinematic. Really early on was done as a prototype.
Yeah, anyway. Yeah, that was. And I remember when we first saw it, it had the original Starkiller uniform on. Mm. They hadn't finished those clothes just yet.
Right.
So okay. that was an interesting. Little moment. I was just thrilled to see that the game was actually being made. Because yeah. I remember I would call you up and nothing obviously was going as fast as it needed to go to make certain miles. I mean, some things obviously were, but there were some major worries about especially the facial tech and stuff like that. So when you finally saw that, you're like, oh, cool. So this might actually happen.
right.
Might actually work out.
Yeah.
But yeah, this the whole thing with Coda and the idea that people's connection to the Force can be cut through misuse, disuse, all those things. And I believe, as I recall, and Hayden can correct me, but I recall that came from George, that he explained.
That's my recollection as well.
Because I remember Hayden explaining that to us, and we were like, what? Mm. How can your connection to the Force be cut? How does that work? So
very cool. Well, this is a lot of fun, you guys.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for what are our feelings about the new Battlefront? Play it now.
Yes,
must
please.
Must play.
Yeah, I
it looks amazing.
It looks absolutely great.
And we both did some work on it, so it's
kinda, we did.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we hope that you like it.
Yeah.
But also we will like it at the same time.
Yes, yes, yes.
And yeah, so that's really cool. Yeah. Kyle Katarn. He's a good guy, that Kyle Katarn. You know, it's
Jedi Knight. Jedi Outcast.
I remember, did I ever tell you this, that when I was about to go out to San Francisco and do Force Unleashed with you guys, I played through Jedi Knight.
Yes.
To sort of familiarize with myself with what it is that we might be doing, to just sort of get in that mindset. I don't know if it was helpful or not, but I certainly had fun because it was, I somehow installed it and got it running again. And that was, I remember that was a big deal because it was live action Star Wars
big
footage.
Deal. Yeah, yeah. Bach.
And we can still quote that, can't we?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Jan, what a pleasant surprise.
Yeah. Yeah. What I can't remember what she says. I just remember him saying, oh, yeah.
Oh, no, I got, no, okay, I'll do her because I do remember what she says. What would you do without me, Kyle?
I'd be a content old man.
Somehow I don't see content or an old man.
Oh. She doesn't say
TIE Fighters.
TIE Fighters.
Yeah, let's get out of here.
What I remember is, I'm going to find out what I need to know using this.
And then, right. Clearly, there's always those times when they're shooting someone, they're like, they're shooting something, and
we're going
really
to
need to see that.
Planet.
There's going
to
be, that. Yeah.
No, no. Those
I don't know.
Those were groundbreaking.
I'll find out when I get there. Checking my phone.
Right. Yes.
Let's see what the. All
right. that's so true. Great. Seriously, though, like groundbreaking. Great.
Totally games. Groundbreaking.
And, yeah, I just remember the poor Jedi on his knees and like Jarek coming into frame like this, like just.
I need some.
Totally. Just take it, man. Please.
And then just out of frame.
Ooh.
Like that.
There was that. And
Morgan Katarn. This dead man holds the valley's location.
I found the Katarn.
Very intriguing. He starts licking his lips and his teeth.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
I love when the Jedi goes.
Totally.
I love that.
Because you're sort of like, are we afraid of him, or does this guy just like a clown? And you're speaking of clown, Bach, man,
yes,
who clearly
like Igor, basically.
That actor didn't see Return of the Jedi because you know you, Bib Fortuna for a while, him and Ula, the dancer in Jabba's palace, were the only examples we had of Twi'lek, potato, potato,
Han,
but
Han, Han,
Hoth, the Hoth system, Lea, and Lea. So that was our only example of those. Of those races, but if you watch those two performances, Ula and Bib Fortuna, they're fairly civilized, you know. They were
and then
you have Bach, and I just feel like the actor, they just got him in the prosthetics and he's like, oh, I know how to do this.
It's Igor.
Yes, you know.
But you know, I'm sure
he's fired.
You gotta trust your director.
He's not only fired, but he's a dead man.
All right,
he's not going anywhere. We're gonna find him, we're gonna kill his family first.
Thoughts on the prequel video games? I worked on many of them. Star Wars Obi-Wan, Bounty Hunter, Star Wars Starfighter, Jedi Starfighter, Clone Campaigns, Episode 3, Republic Commando. I worked on a lot of those. So I have very fond memories. And
do you have a favorite prequel project you work on?
Probably Republic Commando. I mean, that's kind of the obvious answer. It was just such a special game, but really was kind of its own thing. Bounty Hunter was probably, Obi-Wan and Bounty Hunter is where I really kind of cut my teeth, you know, learning about video games, but, you know, really, tough projects, very, challenged projects in terms of scheduling and, you know, but still very proud of the work that I did on those. And it was great to work on Star Wars. I worked on Star Wars Demolition.
Yes.
My first ever Star Wars game.
Sev lives.
I love Sev. Yeah, yeah. Jonathan Cook.
Next time on Fox.
Oh, there I am as a young man with Jason Osipa there. Good picture.
Yeah.
Looking like, what's up, dude?
We've got to find more of these pictures. I keep adding a few to the...
And there's the talented Amy Beth Christensen.
There's Amy Beth Christensen. She's the one who Matt O. talks about a lot in terms of the key of the a lot of the art that you see in this game. Doomsday vs. Starkiller. I'm gonna Superman. Superman wins. Mm. Always, Superman always wins. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Can I crow rumors? James O'Barr expressed that he thought I might be right for that, and I certainly I'm very honored that he would say that, because I'm a huge fan of that character in that graphic novel and the movie. So, and I'm a huge fan of his. So he's a great guy. Delta Squad at Celebration.
I remember that really very, cool. very well. And I remember there was genuine surprise at how big that reaction was when Delta Squad showed up. And it was a great moment for me too. Because you can't help but just have those things be so totally near and dear to your heart, you know. And when Delta Squad showed up in the Clone Wars, that was crazy. And then when Gregor, you know, there was that whole episode where through the Republic Commando visor of the Clone Wars, that was really, really cool.
Well, you know, I remember Matt Wood got your shotgun sounds for that.
Yeah, my Trandoshan Republic Commando shotgun sounds ended up in season three
of Clone Wars.
I forget what those episodes were.
It was the it was with Chewbacca and Ahsoka gets captured by the Trandos.
Mm-hmm, the Trandoshan hunters. They've got a thing against Wookiees.
They really do. They gotta let it go. Gotta let it go. It's too much. That was I remember you being very excited that sound assets that you had developed were going on the show.
I was geeking out. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, what do we say? Until next time, or
until next time, until Hayden Blackman is so tired of us that he wants to come in here.
You guys, we are so sorry. We just are doing it because we love this project and love Star Wars. So you know, all in good fun. but we hope to have more devs on next time, right?
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah. Thanks for staying up late and hanging out with us, and we'll do this again sometime soon.
Yeah, thank you guys. You guys are awesome. You know, a lot of fun. Signing off. We should have like a sign off thing, right? We should be like, see you later.
That was perfect.
Yeah, it's some. May the force
be with you. We'll see you later.
May the force be with you.
All right, guys.